Missing 411, Eastern United States, by David Paulides. A case study. You're listening to Brothers of the Serpent podcast.
And welcome back, ladies and gentlemen, boys and girls, angels and demons and monsters and serpents to Brothers of the Serpent podcast. Coming to you not live from the 10 by 10 by 10 tangent cube of science, nestled amongst the dusty bones of an ancient seabed, high atop the Edwards Plateau. So, following on from last week's episode with Marty about skinwalkers, I think we might start looking back into the missing 411 stuff. I think that it does connect a bit.
Yeah.
So we'll go through some of that today. But first, of course, we got the first segment stuff. So what do we have agriculturally? Like, we haven't... last week was rainy, so there wasn't a lot to do.
Yeah, did I talk about the nets? I guess, yeah, I did.
Yeah, we already closed the nets.
We're basically trying to fight off fungus. It's really hard to do.
Yeah.
We had a little window of opportunity to spray the grapes last week, about 2 weeks and a day since the last spray. You got to get it on there and have it dry up before it rains again.
Yeah.
And the more rain you get, the more vigorous the fungus is. So yeah. It's... yeah, if you don't get a chance to spray, or it was like one day it was just too muddy, you couldn't even drive out there.
Yeah.
But we got it on, so they're protected for the next couple of weeks.
Yeah, is that probably the last time?
Yeah, maybe. But we'll be switching to oxidate, which is a hydrogen peroxide.
Mm. Yeah.
So it's like a organic, non-toxic antifungal or fungicide. So we can spray them all the way up to, you know, like, I don't know, right before harvest, basically.
Yeah. So what was the thing about the salt you were talking about? And it was not magnesium?
No, it was. Magnesium. Yeah, I was questioning whether or not it was magnesium, but I looked it up because I talked about that last week.
Yeah.
And then I was like, was I right about that? And I just, but yeah, that's what it is. It's, I think Epsom salt is magnesium sulfate.
Mm.
But I did talk to... Maureen, who was my instructor at Texas Tech, she said that the uptake in the vine of that magnesium wouldn't be where the magnesium comes from that ends up buffering the pH in the wine.
Hmm.
So the problem is when you have magnesium in there in the grape juice, if you're trying to bring the pH down by adding grape acid, tartaric acid, sometimes it just won't go down. Because it's being buffered by magnesium. So that's why I didn't apply
it. So it's not potassium or whatever that's buffering it. It's magnesium.
It's magnesium.
Okay.
And so if I was going to add 15 pounds of Epsom salt per acre to the vines, I was thinking, well, it's going to take up a bunch of magnesium.
Yeah.
Which is the deficiency, which is what gives the leaves the tiger stripe pattern.
Yeah.
So I didn't do it. And I was like, I'll do it after harvest.
Okay.
But she's telling me that the uptake's not, it won't go into the fruit by that time. But she says they get this burst of magnesium in the fruit, like when you get into the really hot days.
Oh, okay. Hmm.
And I don't know what the mechanism for that is or the physiology of the, I don't understand it. So yeah, I could do that. We could do that injection, I guess.
Yeah. I mean, they look pretty good to me. I did see a few with tiger stripes, but most of them don't seem to have it too bad.
Yeah. It's just here and there, but
yeah.
So yeah, I mean, they're looking good. Turning purple.
Yep. That's right. I posted some pictures of it, of the Verasian.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Lots of fruit.
Yeah. There is a lot of fruit.
Hopefully we can get a machine to harvest it.
You're gonna need a harvest
machine. It's gonna be a lot.
Yeah. Yep. And the garden is amazing. And I guess they're making pickles out of some of those cucumbers. I've been eating them.
Yeah, and they Maria just harvested a giant tub of cilantro seeds.
Hmm.
And I mean, it was beautiful. I was like, how did she get these so clean? It was just like all the seeds and almost nothing else, right? She figured out how to do it. I don't know how she did it. But last year they tried to do it and it was real messy. It had a bunch of stems and all this other stuff. Now she rolled up into the shop with this gigantic tub full of, it's like, I thought they bought them or something. I was like, what are those for? What are we planting? He's like, no, they harvested those. Dang. And I ate one and it was awesome. It was like this burst of, you know, the cilantro flavor, but in this dried seed.
Yeah. And the corn, some of the corn's taller than me.
Yeah.
It's looking good. Yeah, it's looking real good. All right, let's go ahead and do space weather news from spaceweather.com, where we get all our space weather news. It says windy with a chance of storms. Today, a high-speed stream of solar wind is expected to hit Earth's magnetic field. Wind speeds could top 600 kilometers per second, sparking minor G1 class geomagnetic storms and high latitude auroras. The gaseous material is flowing from an equatorial hole in the sun's atmosphere. Also, there was an aurora surprise on July 10th. There was no aurora predicted for that day, but unexpectedly, it says, a crack opened in the Earth's magnetic field for 30 minutes, and the timing was perfect for auroras to show up that night. And they have a picture of where they showed up on spaceweather.com. Also, Venus kisses Mars, so when the sun goes down tonight, step outside and look west. Deep in the evening twilight, Venus is kissing Mars. The two planets are only half a degree apart in the sky. The best time to look is about 45 minutes after local sunset. The planets will be hanging low, so a clear view of the western horizon is essential. Venus pops out of the twilight first, followed later by Mars, and they won't be this close together again until May 11th, 2034.
Hmm.
Yeah. Half a degree apart in the sky. That's pretty close. Yeah. All right, current conditions. Solar wind speed, 317.5 kilometers per second. The density is pretty high at 11.9 protons per cubic centimeter. Current sunspot number is 23. And the neutron count is 9% above the space age average. And the KP index is 2 at quiet. And the 24-hour max is also 2. But that may go up when this solar wind hits us, I guess they're saying. Mm. So
when's it supposed to hit again?
Let's see. It just says today.
Oh.
So it could be any time today. Hasn't hit yet. Let's see. A crypto? Another crypto update here.
It's going through the roof.
Let's hope. I haven't checked it since last week.
I haven't looked at it either.
Yeah. Come on.
It's still hovering around 33, I bet.
Probably.
We're just going to... That's the magic
number.
Is that
your prediction? Put it in the book. Yeah, 32. Bitcoin is at $32,898.77, and Ethereum is at $2,030.23.
All right.
There you go.
All right, and I got a fun story for today. This is from earthsky.org. Snakes, forked tongues, let them smell in stereo. This is by Kurt Schwenk of the University of Connecticut. As dinosaurs lumbered through the humid cycad forests of ancient South America, I don't know how to pronounce that, cycad, but 180 million years ago, primeval lizards scurried unnoticed beneath their feet. Perhaps to avoid being trampled by their giant kin, some of these early lizards sought refuge underground. Here they evolved long, slender bodies and reduced limbs to negotiate the narrow nooks and crevices beneath the surface. Without light, their vision faded, but to take its place, an especially acute sense of smell evolved. It was during this period that these proto-snakes evolved one of their most iconic traits, a long, flicking, forked tongue. These reptiles eventually returned to the surface, but it wasn't until the extinction of the dinosaurs many millions of years later that they diversified into myriad types of modern snakes. I didn't know that. Did you know that? They weren't around during the dinosaurs' time, huh? They were lizards.
Hmm.
The according to this evolutionary biologist.
So they devolved their legs. Is that what they're saying?
Yeah. Okay. Which is weird. Yeah, I thought the same thing. That's weird. As an evolutionary biologist, I, the writer of this story, am fascinated by these bizarre tongues and the role they have played in snakes' success. Snake tongues are so peculiar, they have fascinated naturalists for centuries. Aristotle believed the forked tips provided snakes a twofold pleasure from taste, a view mirrored centuries later by French naturalist Bernard Germain de something, who suggested the twin tips could adhere more closely to the tasty body of the soon-to-be snack. A 17th century astronomer and naturalist Giovanni Battista Hodierna thought snakes use their tongues for picking the dirt out of their noses, since they are always groveling on the ground. Others contended the tongue captured flies with wonderful nimbleness betwixt the forks, or gathered air for sustenance. One of the most persistent beliefs has been that the darting tongue is a venomous stinger, a misconception perpetuated by Shakespeare with his many references to stinging serpents and adders, whose double tongue may with mortal touch throw death upon thy enemies.
What?
I'm sure that was Shakespeare making a some kind of esoteric metaphor.
Yeah.
But anyway, according to the French naturalist and early evolutionist Jean-Baptiste Lamarck, snakes' limited vision obliged them to use their forked tongues to feel several objects at once. Lamarck's belief that the tongue functioned as an organ of touch was the prevailing scientific view by the end of the 19th century. Clues to the true significance of snake tongues began to emerge in the early 1900s when scientists turned their attention to two bulb-like organs located just above the snake's palate, below its nose. Known as Jacobson's or vomeronasal organs, vomeronasal organs, each opens to the mouth through a tiny hole in the palate. Vomeronasal organs are found in a variety of land animals, including mammals, but not in most primates, so humans don't experience whatever sensation they provide. Scientists found that vomeronasal organs are, in fact, an offshoot of the nose, lined with similar sensory cells that send impulses to the same part of the brain as the nose. And they discovered that tiny particles picked up by the tongue tips ended up inside the vomeronasal organ. These breakthroughs led to the realization that snakes use their tongues to collect and transport molecules to their vomeronasal organs, not to taste them, but to smell them. In 1994, I used film and photo evidence to show that when snakes sample chemicals on the ground, they separate their tongue tips far apart just as they touch the ground. This action allows them to sample odor molecules from two widely separated points simultaneously. And then he has like this picture here of the snake tongue coming out, and
it's slowed down so you can see it.
Yeah, the fork starts out close together and then it gets real wide, and the tips just touch the ground.
Yeah.
Each, see that? When I used to catch snakes, that was one of the things that I would do. I would hold, and I particularly the puff adder, the hog nose.
Yeah.
I would hold the snake head like just close enough to my nose to where when it stuck its tongue out, it could just barely touch my nose.
Right.
And I noticed that this actually made them docile.
Yeah, they would sample. Yeah, you sample.
They're like checking me out, right? Yeah, just touching my nose. So he's like smelling me.
Yeah.
In stereo.
Yeah.
Weird. Each tip delivers to its own vomeronasal organ separately, allowing the snake's brain to assess instantly which side has the stronger smell. Snakes have two tongue tips for the same reason you have two ears. It provides them with directional or stereo smell with every flick, a skill that turns out to be extremely useful when following scent trails left by potential prey or mates. Fork-tongued lizards, the legend of the legged cousins of snakes, do something very similar, but snakes take it one step farther. Unlike lizards, when snakes collect odor molecules in the air to smell, they oscillate their forked tongues up and down in a blur of rapid motion. To visualize how this affects the air movement, graduate student Bill Ryerson and I used a laser focused into a thin sheet of light to illuminate tiny particles suspended in the air. Nice. This is cool. We discovered that the flickering snake tongue generates two pairs of small swirling masses of air, or vortices, that act like tiny fans, pulling odors in from each side and jetting them directly into the path of each tongue tip. Since odor molecules in the air are few and far between, we believe snakes' unique form of tongue flicking serves to concentrate the molecules and accelerate their collection onto the tongue tips. Preliminary data also suggests that the airflow on each side remains separate enough for snakes to benefit from the same stereo smell they get from odors on the ground. Owing to history, genetics, and other factors, natural selection often falls short in creating optimally designed animal parts. But when it comes to the snake tongue, evolution seemed to have hit one out of the park.
Yeah.
I doubt any engineer could do better. Kurt Schwenk, professor of ecology and evolutionary biology at the University of Connecticut.
So wow.
That's really cool.
Yeah.
So, yeah, they have another image of the snake tongue. It's just a still image, but the fork, they've got smoke in the air, and you can see the tongue is in the upward sweep, and there's these two vortices right underneath it.
Yeah. Like,
that's really cool.
Yeah.
Stereo smell.
Yeah, so it's like we have two nostrils, but they're not stereo, right? Because it just goes into doesn't it go to the same passage, basically?
I don't know. Yeah.
Is it separate in there? I mean, if you want to follow a smell, you have to kind of like move around.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
It's
just a matter of strength, right? Like how strong is the smell when I go this way?
Yeah, right.
Or you figure out like, is the wind blowing and which direction is it coming from?
Yeah. 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 I'm trying to think about it now. Like, have I gone in somewhere and, you know, you take a sniff and you're like, you look behind you like you know, like, wow, that smells good. It's back there. Is that?
I don't know. We'll have to pay more attention.
Yeah, I need to pay more attention. What data do I get instantly before I start moving around to try to figure out where the smell's coming from?
Yeah. But we were also talking about, the actual receptors numbers.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah,
like, dog has like millions more.
Yes. Yeah, I don't remember the exact numbers, but it was something like a dog has hundreds, you know, like 100 times or more, 200 yeah. times what a human does in terms of, you know, the smell sensors. And so it was just like, it's interesting to think about it, you know, for a dog, it's normal to go to an area and be like, oh yeah, you know, a couple of my friends, like other dogs, were here 2 weeks ago and they went over there and they were chasing a squirrel. And
yeah.
Oh wow, the squirrel's still there. They didn't find it, right? The dog just knows all this stuff,
yeah.
You know, whether it actually thinks that way, but all that data is apparent. You know, imagine if your sense of smell worked that clearly, like, you know, you go outside and you can basically see tracks of,
yes.
of all the people in your family and where they went.
Yeah.
You could follow them precisely and know how old yeah. they were, you yeah. know,
like the car comes back and you're like, oh, you went to the gas station. Like,
yeah.
I know which gas station you went to because yeah. it's on the tires.
That's
you know
right.
what I mean?
Yeah, exactly.
That, I mean, I'm sure they can do that.
Yeah.
That's crazy.
Yeah.
That's really
and
cool.
That kind of ties into what we're going to be talking about later today or
Super,
later in this. Yeah. Cause you know, a lot of these cases, they bring dogs out there and, you know, in Paulides' work, a lot of the cases, the dogs don't work. Now, I have read so much different conflicting things about the ability of dogs. I'd love to talk to somebody who does this, who trains or works with, you know, with highly
training
trained
dogs.
Dogs. Yeah, maybe we can. I know they have a canine unit out here
sure,
in
we
our
could
town.
Sure, we could find somebody.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's a good point. That would be a really good
yeah, I'd really like to know, like, you know, because one of the things I've read is people are like, look, the dogs are really awesome, but they're not infallible. But
yeah.
comparative to every other possible way we have of tracking people who are lost in the wilderness, they're the best instrument you've got.
Well, we need to freaking train some snakes.
Yeah, right. Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. But I just
search and rescue
just
monkeys.
Real quick before we get into it. Yeah. But they're hominids. I mean, they're
I know, yeah.
they're going to suck.
Yeah.
Before we get into this, like I don't think we've ever talked about this on the show, but you know, there's the whole thing of like, what would your superpower be? You know, if you were a superhero.
Yeah.
I got a new one now. It's stereo smell.
Stereo smell. Yeah.
I'd be the super sniffer or something. I want to see the world in terms of smell.
Yeah. Yeah, that's interesting. Like, I don't know if you've ever, if anybody out there's ever read the Wheel of Time series, but there was a, in that, you know, this is fantasy sci-fi or whatever.
Yeah, I got to start those audiobooks.
Yeah, but there was a person, there were people in that world who had a skill called sniffing, and they would use them as, they would become what they called thief trackers or, you know, but they just called them sniffers. Mm-hmm. And it was all on the DL because most of the sniffers were men. And in this story, it's only the women who are allowed to have the magical powers, because anything that the men have, like, there's a huge, I don't want to go into it, but basically if men have the power, it can be really, really bad because it's been tainted. So there was a taint on the male half of the power. So the sniffers were kept on the DL, but it was interesting because the way the guy worked is he could smell violence. And he could tell you how old it was. And so if there were violent people, he could just follow them.
Wow.
Yeah.
Hmm.
And he could tell you, like, yeah, they were
it's
here.
Like a soul sniffing.
They were here.
Or something.
They were here 3 days ago. You know, and the guy could, like, he would sniff the air and be like, yeah, this dude's real bad. Like, he's killed a lot of people, and recently.
Yeah. So, there was a part in the Witcher series where he knows this guy who was a werewolf.
Yeah. That's right.
And he's married. He's got his whole werewolf family.
Yeah.
And he goes over there. And of course, the wife and the kids don't know him because they had, you know, he had met the guy before he got married a long time ago.
Yeah.
And they could have been enemies, but he ended up helping him out and they became friends.
That's right.
And he needs him. He needs him for
to track.
Yeah.
Yeah. For tracking.
But he shows up over there and, like, causes all this mayhem because he's not home and the family's home, and then they try to kill him. So,
yeah, that's right. They think he's coming for them. Yeah,
yeah.
That's
right. And so when he's talking to the guy, the husband, father, later, he's like, "Well, yeah, man, you smell like death." And he's like, "What do you mean?" He's like, "Well, you have blood on you. You have.
Yeah.
I can smell your blood.
Yeah,
it's like 2 weeks old.
Yeah, and then
and then I can smell a whole lot of other people's blood.
Yeah,
and that's also 2 weeks old. And then there's some much older blood.
Yeah,
of a lot of other things.
All the monsters he's killed. Yeah, exactly. Yeah.
So yeah,
smell like death.
The family. He walks in, and the family's just like, "Oh my gosh, this guy's here to kill us."
That's right. Yeah, that's right. I do remember that. Yeah,
that was cool.
Yeah. Yeah, and Geralt is also supposed to have a heightened sense of smell being a witcher, but not as good as a werewolf.
Like that,
Yeah. All right.
Fiction. Okay.
Yeah, fiction is good. Okay, let's tackle some emails here. We're still trying to catch up. I don't know if it's ever going to happen. Okay, so this one, this is a good long one. It is from Anonymous. It says, "Greetings. It's called Dark Matter from episode 180. Greetings, Kyle and Russ. Been meaning to comment on this matter for a while, but I keep forgetting until I recently listened to that episode of Mindscape with Lena Nasib. I only have a bachelor degree in physics and astronomy and an old one at that, so don't take my words too seriously." Well, that's better than we got, buddy.
What we got.
Yeah. So he says, "I agree." So you may have to listen to this episode of Mindscape with Lena to fully understand what he's saying here. But he says, "I agree with that the way Lena and Sean dismiss the 'can we just tweak gravity' argument to make the dark matter go away is less than satisfactory."
Yeah.
"I'm also well aware of the amount of fixing relativity proposals that physics professors get in their inbox, so I'm sure that factors into how much they talk about these matters in public. Given all that, I still think that they are correct on this. What they're bringing up is the various studies on estimating the mass of the observable universe using the cosmic microwave background data from the WMAP satellite. These studies show that there should be more mass than what we can see. The way that they derive the mass is independent of gravity, hence it's not just gravity that we have to fix and make all the extra mass go away."
That's right.
"This is how I understand the derivation of the mass of the invisible universe. The CMB is the first light of the universe, hence it should contain everything that makes up the universe. The WMAP data gives us a high-resolution temperature data on the cosmic microwave background. You can get the energy density of the matter from the temperature data. This relies on the standard model. Using special relativity, or E equals MC squared, you can get the mass density of the universe.
Special relativity does not involve gravity or space-time curvature. It's mainly the consequence of the speed of light being constant in a vacuum. The finer point that you can argue here is that this mass is technically inertial mass. There are experiments that show the equivalence of inertial mass and gravitational mass, but we really don't have direct theoretical connection between the two. Or theoretical, he says. General relativity assumes that inertial and gravitational mass are the same. In the standard model, it wasn't settled if the two are the same back when I was in school. I don't know if the Higgs field or particle solves this now. So yeah, if you're looking to break general relativity, the best option is to show that light speed is not constant, or that there's significant difference between inertial mass and gravitational mass. And P.S., the vibrational solid phenomena you guys were trying to describe on episode 180 is called a phonon in wave physics. Yours sincerely, Anonymous.
Wow, man, that's awesome.
Yeah, that's cool
stuff. Wish you weren't anonymous, but...
Yeah.
Cool. Yeah, so I think it's...
And I agree with the question of inertial mass versus gravitational mass is an interesting one. Yeah. Because if basically...
I just think all those things are on the table.
Yeah.
Okay, because the current constant speed of light may not have always been the constant speed of light in the past.
Right.
Like, if the density of the medium that it's traveling in, whatever it is, was different, that it could have been a different speed.
Yeah.
So, of course, the standard model doesn't think of it in terms of a medium, but since the rise of quantum field theory, it basically is. It's a medium.
Yeah.
It's a bunch of fields.
Yeah.
So the nature of those fields do they consider them constant forever since the beginning? I don't know. I think that's on the table. And I think that because I've read enough scientists who also think that.
Yeah.
And they have problems with the general relativity, and they have problems with, the celestial mechanics, the aspect of dark matter, which is, the visually seeing the organization of galaxies.
Mm-hmm.
So you're right. That's one way. If you only look at the dark matter problem in that way and disregard the cosmic microwave background information, then it looks like you can modify gravity and fix it. But it becomes more complicated.
Yeah.
When you look at the cosmic microwave background, because you have to change other things, like you're saying.
Yes.
I just think those things are on the table.
Right. Yeah.
Redshift is part of that too, right?
Yep. Yeah. And yeah,
it's really old light.
Yeah. Right.
Or were the circumstances just different when it was created?
Yeah. Yep.
So I don't know. But that's great stuff, man. Appreciate
that. Yeah, really good. Okay. So this is a person from Sweden. I have no idea how to say either one of the names that are in here. Let's see. One of them looks like Piotr. Maybe. Maybe. What do you think? P-I-O-T-R.
Piotr.
Piotr.
Don't know.
Says, hello, snakes. I have just recently started listening to your podcasts and quickly got addicted to listening to them on a daily basis with a plan to hear all available episodes. Why? Because you do a great job and your podcasts are cool and interesting, and I like the fact that you touch a lot of different subjects. Nice. I thought of asking you if you have heard of Longyear Caves. As much as I could dig into any mm-hmm. details, there isn't particularly much information about who, when, and why built them. There are no historical records about this place. I know that lichenometric dating was performed there to date the place, as well as they found some tools somewhere around, which is obviously, quote unquote, a sufficient proof when the place was built around 230 BC. Again, here we have an enormous project that was somehow engineered, and you have flat surfaces, drainage systems, a way to dig up stone in seriously hard conditions, and a really interesting chiseling marks. Fabulous. I would love to hear your thoughts about it. Have you heard of or already talked about any unexplained or mysterious sites in China, like the Chinese pyramids? Take care. Keep up the great work. Thumbs up. Cheers from Sweden.
Yeah, Longyear Grottoes, right?
Yes, the Longyear Grottoes, Longyear Caves. Yeah, yeah. I agree.
You might be able to find that if you search that at the website.
Yes, it's possible.
They might be.
We definitely talked about them in older episodes, didn't do a serious deep dive, but yeah. We did talk about them. Yeah, they are mysterious. One of the big questions is, where is all the stone?
Yeah, that they took out.
They excavated a lot of material, and it's nowhere in evidence around the area, this very small area where the caves were. It wasn't a mining operation because there's nothing to mine there except rock. If they were quarrying, they did it the hard way because the entrances are all, they basically small. Dug caves and the entrances are all very small.
Yeah.
And they made tunnels.
These are the ones that were full of water and they kept like.
That's right.
They're just like pumping them out.
Yeah. This is based on what I know from reading, what I've read. Obviously it's not, I haven't checked up on this because you would need to really contact locals there and talk to them about it. But the idea was that in this area, all the locals, these are poor farmers, they've been there forever. They knew about these pools. They were small pools of water and they considered them to be bottomless.
Yeah.
And they thought of them as bottomless pools and they were all over the place. There were dozens of them in the area. And eventually one guy, who sounds like a snake bro to me.
He's just like, let's pump these out.
Yeah, he's like, what the fuck is this bottomless bullshit? And they were crystal clear and they had big fish in them.
Yeah.
And so he was just like, what? So he and three of his buddies they pool their money and they get a big pump and they drop it down in there and they start pumping the water out. And the level's going down and down and down.
And starts revealing stairs.
Yeah, there's like stelas sticking out and like all this carving, and they're like, okay. And so they keep paying and they keep pumping it out, and it reveals a multi-level, enormous underground complex. And there's dozens of these around there. So, from what I've read, again, I don't know if this is confirmed or not, but from what I've read, there's a whole bunch of them. They're all very close to each other, and none of them intersect each other underground. Which is interesting because it's like down underground, like when you map them out now, you find out that some of these separate systems have tunnels that basically go
around each other. That's right.
They're weaving around each other.
They knew where the other ones were.
That's right. Yeah. Like it was a coordinated effort. And for whatever reason, they never made them connect.
Yeah.
Like they were making separate chambers, but in some cases the tunnels from different systems come really close to each other, but never actually intersect. Yeah. It's cool stuff. And there's some great photos you can find.
This is the kind of stuff that just makes me jealous, It's like, how come there's not bottomless pools where we live? It's like, let's pump those out.
Yeah. Yeah.
Dang it. Two guys bought a pump. Discovered amazing ancient freaking tunnel system. Like,
yeah.
Damn it.
Yeah, and the question, other questions are, where did the fish go? Like, apparently, from what I've read, again, I don't know if this is totally confirmed, but after they pumped all the water out, the fish were nowhere in evidence. So that makes you wonder, like, well, are the fish getting in there some other way? Did the pump suck all the fish up and grind them up and throw them out? I don't know, but like, they pump all the water out, and there aren't fish like flopping around in the bottom. So what's going on?
Yeah, yeah.
And I've seen people asking, like, well, where did the water come from? Well, supposedly it's seepage because the stone.
It's limestone, right?
Yeah, the stone. Well, it's a sedimentary rock.
Yeah.
But yeah, it's I don't know if it's specifically limestone, but yes, it's sedimentary rock. So the water is in there because of seepage.
My inner Skerptard is bothered by the fish story. I'm just like.
Yeah. That may be apocryphal. I mean, it may be bullshit. I don't know. I remember reading it. Like, there were fish in there. They all caught fish. And supposedly the fish were big and you could just go up to the pool and like catch them with your hands,
when they came to the surface.
Yeah. You could catch them with your hand and they pumped all the water out and there's no fish. So that's I don't know what that means, but that is part of the story.
Maybe they were ground up in the pump.
Exactly.
A serious pump.
Serious pump. Yeah. But yeah, I agree, man. The Longview grottos are very interesting. And yes, they're at least one of them has some artwork in it. That looks like a depiction of some possible Chinese mythology. I don't know. I don't know if that dates to the cave itself or if it was later addition. It's not really possible to tell. And yeah, they gave it a rough age of about 2,000 years old. And it's,
And as far as the Chinese, I think what you're talking about is the giant triangular orchards.
Yes. Yeah. Yeah,
because they plant trees all over.
Yeah, they plant trees all over the. And like, are they pyramids or are they more like the mounds that we had here?
Earthen mounds.
Earthen mounds. Yeah, Because you can't plant trees on
But pyramid. I mean, the pyramids in Mexico, the Pyramid of the Sun was covered in dirt.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Definitely a lot of the Mayan stuff is just looks like a mound of dirt before they clean it off too. Yeah, with stuff growing on it. So
yeah,
yeah, yeah. They could be stone pyramids. It's just not clear. There's a whole bunch of them too.
There's gigantic pyramids in Mexico were just covered in dirt.
Yeah, it is weird.
Like they were intentionally buried, mm-hmm. like Göbekli Tepe.
Yeah.
Because I mean, how do you get the dirt on there? What deposited the dirt?
10,000 years of wind. I don't know. Once you get enough on there and then grass starts growing, it holds it. And
yeah.
Keeps building up. I don't know. That's supposedly how it works.
It's just wild.
Yeah. But I mean, I remember we went to that place in Guatemala and there were like two of the big pyramids that had been cleared off. Right. They had been cleaned up and you could see the structure and it was stone.
Yeah. Like,
but there were other enormous mounds like off in the jungle mounds. Around there, and they were just fuzzy and covered in. Yeah. And those were other pyramids that hadn't been excavated yet. So, yeah, I don't know how they, you know, a steep sided, you know, Mayan style stone pyramid becomes covered in dirt and becomes this like pointed hill. That's green. It's weird.
Yeah, they're in the deep jungle with gigantic trees that are dropping leaves and stuff on them all the time,
yeah,
sticks and everything.
True.
It's like all this fiber. Mm-hmm. And then you get the moss growing on that. And, you know, you can see in that jungle how that happens. But the ones in China, you just like.
Yeah, they're out.
But I guess all that stuff's now cultivated. So maybe thousands of years ago, it was just forest.
It was under a jungle. Yeah. Could have been under a forest. Yeah.
I don't know. Really interesting stuff.
Yeah.
We're running up on time. You got one more?
Yeah, this one's short. We'll do one more. This is about episode 178.
So we just need to shut up more and then we can get through more emails.
Yeah. This is from Richard. He says, "Greetings, Snake Brothers. Bounded by the impossibility of talking back, I here express my thoughts." The eye injection on mice. So I guess we read a story in 178 about eye injections on mice to allow them to see other spectra. Remember that?
I think so.
"I think that we should expect a very different reaction with humans. After all, our eyes might have lost the ability to see outside of the current spectrum, but our brain might still be able to translate it into a visual image. It would be very interesting to see the results. As for powering cars with wireless tech, I see this as a very simple matter. Just build towers to capture the energy, space them along the roads as required, and then use them to power a simple inductive plate that could be placed in each lane of the road, highway, or everywhere you want them.
Yeah.
This is all doable with present day tech."
Yeah.
"My best regards from Richard." Yeah.
Agree with that.
Yep. That's,
that would be, yep.
Yeah, and I was thinking, when I first read this, I was like, that's a lot of towers. But then I'm like, well, every road is lined with
towers.
With poles, with power poles already. So, yeah.
Yeah.
Yep. All right.
And if you could make them hover, we wouldn't have to pave the roads. We just have to mow the roads.
Right. Yeah. Just keep them mowed. All right. Well, let's take a break.
Stereo snakes. We're back, ladies and gentlemen, and start the sands of time.
Yeah.
Diving back into the 411.
That's right.
Nice segue. Even though we don't need segues.
Segues are unnecessary. So yeah, this is a missing 411 Eastern United States book. So the ones we did years ago, those stories were from the Western United States book.
Yeah.
So this is part of the original set of 411 cases that he decided to, that Paulides, David Paulides decided to write about.
And this subject.
Before he expanded his searches.
This subject kept popping up in my mind as we were going through the whole UFO stuff.
Right.
With Marty.
Yeah. So this is one of the ones I've read before, but I went back through it. I saw it on my bookshelf the other day with all the other missing 411. I was like, you know, maybe we could talk about some cases from that book. Because I, my original plan with the missing 401 is I wanted to go through, because Dave does a fantastic job when he goes on. I feel like he does a really good job when he goes on other shows, and he has like a set list of cases that he talks about, and those are the big cases with lots of details. Yeah. So if you listen to him multiple times when he's discussing the same book, he's discussing basically the same cases. He's talking about Dennis Martin, you know, he's talking about Bart Schleyer. Like, these are the big cases that he discusses. But my goal when we started doing our shows on it was I wanted to go through some of the less lower profile cases in the book and give people a more clear indication of what's happening. Because to me, it's not about any individual case. Like, yes, individual cases are strange, but a lot of times, Kyle's pointed this out, they lack details that allow you to really understand what's happening. In some cases, you want to ask questions that there aren't answers to.
Yeah.
Right. So to me, it's more about the effect of the book is you read through and you see patterns. Now, does this pattern emerge because of the lack of details? Possible. You know, but
some people accuse him of being, you know, it's a selection bias.
Yeah. Yeah. And I think, I guess the selection bias is proper in the, if you're trying to profile something.
Yeah. I mean,
but the question is there a selection bias within individual cases? Like, you know, people have said, well, he doesn't give you like a pertinent piece of information in an individual case that makes it a mundane thing. Maybe that's true.
Well, you would have to, you'd have to go research the case in separately to know that.
And that's hard to do on the ones that are old.
Yeah.
So what I've done here in this book, and again, I'm going to put the links to buy the book in the show notes and to the website and everything. I encourage everybody to go get these books because it's really about reading the entire thing that you kind of see things emerge. So one thing I will say is I did notice, as I was reading through this again, I did notice, like, because I, you know, you often hear people say, well, you can tell he thinks it's Bigfoot, right? Even though he never says anything like that in the book.
Right.
Now, when I was reading through this, I'm like, okay, I can see how people might think that, because there's some cases where he's wondering, you know, he's wondering, like, there's footprints that are bare feet, and he's, you know, and he's like, okay, what is that? And they're alongside a boot print. And he's like, what does this mean? You know? You got a barefoot footprint alongside a boot print, you know, and then there's like strange hairy men or wild men or whatever that, like in the Dennis Martin case specifically, there was the key, and it was a key piece of evidence that was witnessed by a family whose last name was Key, you know, which is a strange coincidence, you know, where they went out to look for bears and this is a weird thing. Does this really happen? You know, they said that they asked a park ranger, like, where can we see bears? And the park ranger's like, yeah, go down this trail. Like, do they really do that? Like, you're really going to send somebody in an area where you know where their bears are? I don't know. But anyway, they saw.
And just to clarify, when you say barefoot footprint, you're not talking about a bear.
Right. Talking about a foot with no shoe on. Exactly. Yeah. So. They say that they saw an upright man who their son initially thought was a bear. So that implies that it's like hairy or something.
Yeah.
And
or maybe he's wearing a big fur coat.
Yeah. He could have been wearing furs. And then later David talks to, I can't remember the guy's name, but he's an old park ranger who did a lot of search and rescue, and he was involved in the Dennis Martin case. And he says, yeah, there are what he calls wild men living in the Great Smoky Mountains. But in that, David is like, when we're talking about wild men, this guy is specifically talking about human beings that have gone to live in the wild. Mm. And so, they may be hairy and scary looking, but they're not like a cryptid.
Yeah.
Okay. Anyway, so what I've done is I've marked a bunch of cases in this book that I kind of want to go through. It may take two episodes, but there's, for the most part, the pattern that I'm going with here are very young children who disappeared basically from their backyards. You know, basically they disappear within small distance of the rest of their family members. And most of the time they're found alive. That's the pattern I'm going with here, because those are the ones that are harder to explain. You know, when the kid disappears and it's just they're gone without a trace and no evidence is ever found, that's a mystery, but anything could have happened. So when you find the child alive, or maybe, you know, they find it very recently deceased, which does happen in some of these cases, there's more data.
Yeah.
You know, so that's what I'm going with here, except there are a few cases. There will be some scattered in here that aren't that, but the reason I pick those is because they have strange details that I want to talk about.
Okay.
Okay, so this first one, this is in Minnesota. The name is Corey Kelly. Age at disappearance is 38 years, so the first one's not a kid. Okay. Went missing in 2006. Is that right? Yeah, 2006. Sometimes it's hard to tell because 06 might be 1906. Yeah, so went missing 10/16/06. So Corey and his friend Jim go grouse hunting in northern Minnesota. His name is Corey Kelly. Kelly made the trip from his home in Crookstown, Minnesota to the Red Lake State Wildlife Management Area. And then his friend Jim joins him on the 16th of October. They set up their camp when Jim realizes they need gas, which they had forgotten to get. So he says he'll go to the nearest town and get gas. Corey stays behind with Jim's dog. So Jim says that he last saw Corey 200 yards south of the camp with his shotgun, and he was headed out to shoot grouse, going out to hunt with the dog. Jim leaves the campsite at 5:30 p.m., and he returns an hour and a half later at 7 p.m. So he arrives back at the campsite to find evidence that Corey had been collecting firewood, but he couldn't find him. It was getting late, close to dark, so he starts to get nervous. He also realizes that his own dog, Sammy, a golden Labrador, was missing. He could see that Corey had taken his shotgun, and then late in the night it starts to rain. So darkness comes. Jim honks the horn and flashes the truck lights for a long time, trying to show him how to get back. It became really late, and so he goes to bed, hoping that he'll show up in the morning. He wakes up at 4 a.m., starts searching again, can't locate him. So he walked almost 2 miles around the campsite looking for him, couldn't find him. So then he flags down two people passing by the campsite and explains somebody was missing and asks them to notify law enforcement. Okay. So Corey had been visiting this exact area of the Red Lakes since he was a child. This was the first visit for Jim. So then the sheriff, Keith Winger, takes the lead on the organization of the search. Searchers combed the area of the campsite and with the use of ATVs started to expand their search into the wilderness. Difficult terrain, tall grasses, lots of water, swamps, and bogs. For almost 2 weeks, searchers found nothing. On Wednesday, October 25th, two hunters 9 miles from the camp found the Labrador, the dog, wandering in the woods.
Wow.
The dog was dehydrated and hungry, but in generally good condition. On Saturday, October 28th, searchers found Corey's cigarette lighter and cigarettes. On October 29th, trackers from the Minnesota Bureau of Criminal Apprehension, which is interesting, find his overalls, socks, and sweatshirt 14 miles from the original campsite.
What?
On October 30th, Beltrami County Emergency Management Coordinator Beryl Wernberg stated that weather had hindered the search and that they were terminating their efforts at this point. Snow had started to fall and there were 2 inches of snow on the ground. In mid-November, the search for Corey started again. The best search dogs in Minnesota were brought. After 13 more days, they were still unable to locate Corey. On November 23rd, the search for Corey was terminated for winter. Searchers had now conducted 2 different searches, each lasting approximately 2 weeks, and they had found clothing 14 miles from the campsite and scoured that location for Corey, but he was not found. So the next year, April 28th, the search for Corey resumes, with the sheriff's department flying over the area where Corey's clothes and other personal belongings were found. North of the Rapid River Walking Bridge off of Rapid River Road, near to the Moose River Road, and north of Fortown, so he's just giving you the area, The air team spots a body among 8-foot-tall reeds 15 feet off the trail. The body the air team spotted was Corey. So Corey's mother is interviewed after the body was recovered and after the search team and sheriff's department debriefed her. On October 31st, she said, "The sheriff's department can't believe he got 14 miles from the campsite, and he probably got there somehow the first night. He must have been flying through the trees and the bushes. I can't believe he could have gotten that far." So Paulides says that he ordered the report on the incident from the county, the Beltrami County Sheriff, and a copy of the cause of death from the coroner's office, and the death certificate stated that he died from hypothermia. So Paulides says he's in total agreement with Corey's mother. He can't believe Corey could leave late in the afternoon, travel 14 plus miles through the swamp to his final destination. In the reports he did receive from the sheriff's department, there is one form that states that the dog was located. It was found in the general area that Corey went missing. Biological samples were taken from the dog and forwarded to a lab. The report states that the remains and samples were going to be checked for human remains or clothing. The samples were taken to the lab on October 26 of 2006. So Dave says in his summary here, he says he's personally studied the Corey Kelly case for 2 years. It's been a search and rescue incident that disturbed him. Corey was not new to the area. He had been visiting the area of Red Lake Management Area for 25 years. He was an experienced hunter and camper, knew the dangers associated with hunting in November in Minnesota. He also knew not to hunt at night and that this specific area posed extreme dangers after dark because of the bogs and swamps. The sheriffs did not explain why they felt Corey died the first night, but it is obvious to everyone that traveling that distance through that type of terrain doesn't make any sense. A person would have to be practically superhuman to travel that distance in that time frame. So then he says, why were Corey's clothes off? So if he died of hypothermia, you know, the argument here is paradoxical undressing took place. And so he sheds all his clothing. But again, usually the body is found pretty close to the area where the shed clothing happens because they don't get far after that. They're already in the process of dying and they're completely, you know, now every person is different. So I don't know. So maybe he could shed his clothes and then keep walking basically naked through the snow in the woods and die far away from his clothes. It's also interesting that they find him 15 feet from a trail, but in in very tall reeds where the body's hidden.
Yeah,
that's
hidden.
Yes. It's right off the trail, but hidden in the reeds.
Yeah. So he was found in the general area of the clothing. Because the clothing was found 14 miles away.
It doesn't say specifically.
Well, I mean, but...
Yeah, so, okay.
His cigarettes...
They were flying over the area where his clothes and other personal belongings were found. And they spotted the body.
Yeah, but when it says they found his clothes, they said, like, 14 miles.
Right.
So he was found in the general area where his clothes were.
Yes, they were searching the area where his clothes had been found when they found him. Yeah. He was among 8-foot-tall reeds.
Yeah.
They only could see him from the air.
Were those reeds...
It's like swamp reeds.
Were they new? I mean, because...
Yeah, I don't know.
They'd gone through winter.
Right.
So that's weird.
Yeah, so he says...
But it's just weird to think that, like, you know, something happened within that hour and a half.
Yeah.
Basically, something happened almost immediately after the guy left.
Exactly. Point of separation.
And, like, why didn't the dog return to the campsite? That's just really strange.
Right. Yeah.
Because once the dog gets separated from the guy, the person he's with...
Yeah.
It seems like the dog would just go back to the campsite.
The dog would go back to the campsite, yeah.
So it's like something kept the dog from going back.
Yeah. And also...
How long?
If he died from hypothermia, why did he die from hypothermia? He had a cigarette. He had a cigarette case and lighter. So that's another question. Like, if he did get lost and he's out there in the middle of the night, he's got a lighter. He can make a fire, right? I mean, you could make a fire, and yet they find it discarded. Like, he throws it out. Like, you know, screw this. And, like, dude, no smoker tosses his smokes. Okay.
Yeah, man.
It's really strange. And they never found his gun. And that's the other thing is, like, experienced hunters who get lost know you fire your gun into the... If you're lost, you know, boom, boom, you shoot your gun into the air because that can attract people to where you are.
They never found his gun. That's freaking crazy.
Yeah. And Paulides points out that, like, there was a dog with him, so if he somehow loses his lighter and he can't make a fire, well, a dog's real warm. You can, you know,
cuddle up with the dog.
Snuggle with the dog. It's a, you know, it's a Labrador. You can snuggle with the dog overnight to keep yourself warm and stave off hypothermia. And yeah, Dave asks, why didn't search and rescue teams locate his firearm? He was located in the middle of a very high patch of grass 15 feet off of a main walking path. Why would any person choose to stay in the high grass versus a clear and defined walking path? If a person wanted to be found, he would stay in one place, not walk or run 14 miles in one night. So those are, I think the first one is like, yes, you know, they always tell you if you're lost, stop moving, but that doesn't happen. People panic. So I don't know if that's a good point, but I do agree that it's weird that he's found in really tall grass right off the walking path. Like, why wasn't he dead on the
path?
Yeah,
I just don't know. I mean, you have to...
Maybe he was trying to hide from the wind.
Well, you just have to know what the foliage is like in the area. Like, because is that grass going to live through winter?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
You know, was it tall grass when he went there?
Right.
Was the grass depressed underneath his body?
Yeah. Yep.
Or did it just grow up around him when the spring came? You know what I mean?
Yeah. So Paulides says, another oddity to this story is the condition of Sammy, the dog. He was found several days after Corey disappeared. Searches stated that the dog had eaten deer meat to stay alive.
Whoa.
How did the searchers know that the dog ate deer meat? Was this through the biological samples taken from the stomach? Where did the deer meat come from? Searchers also stated that Sammy was dehydrated. There is more fresh water in the Red Lakes area than most people could possibly imagine. How could the dog be dehydrated unless he was somehow confined and restricted?
Mm-hmm. I thought that was strange, too.
Yeah. The last and most obvious indicator that something very, very odd happened to Corey is that his cell phone was never used. Yes, there is only intermittent cell reception in this area. But if a person were traveling 14 to 15 miles across a wide open region, he or she would have reception or the phone would have pinged a transponder or repeater of the phone's location occasionally, and this did not happen.
Wow.
The area that Corey disappeared is some of the most desolate, rural, and hard-to-walk locations in North America. He says, Paulides says he has no doubt there are thousands of acres in this area that have never been walked by a human being ever, which is an interesting concept. I've always wondered that, you know, when we go out hiking some really remote place, I'm like, has anybody ever actually walked on this spot before?
You know? Yeah.
So,
well, that is definitely, I mean, people imagine that, you know, we've explored everything.
Yeah. Nope.
No.
Not even.
I mean, there are vast areas of forest in the United States alone that have never, like, there's no known people that have been there. I mean, there could be freaking indigenous tribes up there that we wouldn't know about.
Yeah. Uncontacted tribes.
Right? Yeah, uncontacted tribes.
So Paulides says, I want everyone to understand that Corey left the campsite well prepared. He had the following items: cell phone, lighter, cigarettes, dog, coat, firearm, ammunition, and warm winter clothing. All of the above items were recovered except the firearm. One shell was recovered, but others were not. Corey's socks were found near other clothes, again, presumably discarded on the first night. There's something very wrong with this scenario, presented by the sheriff, of Corey disappearing and eventually finding his body. So I agree with that. I listed that one, obviously, because it's just a strange...
Yeah, that's really weird.
It's a really strange one. Now, again, you can come up with scenarios in your mind, but... What you have to try to do is keep the details of each case in mind as we go through case by case, because you'll see them popping up again and again. Now, could this be a symptom of getting lost and something that people do when they panic? I don't know. I'm just interested in the patterns. Okay, so the next case here, this one is in Wisconsin. The name is Colleen. Age at disappearance, 18 months. Missing in 7/3 in 1988 at 6 p.m. in the Menominee Indian Reservation in Wisconsin. Okay, so Kenesha in Wisconsin is approximately 40 miles north of Oshkosh and 10 miles south of the Menominee Indian Reservation. The area around the reservation is wet and swampy, and the majority of farmland is south of Kenesha, but the Kenesha area has woodlands. Colleen was reported at missing at 6 p.m. by her parents from her home inside the reservation. Law enforcement officials immediately responded, and a search started soon after their arrival. By 10 p.m., so four hours later, on the evening of the disappearance, many people were searching for Colleen. Still hadn't been found by 8 a.m. the following morning, and yet there were hundreds of volunteers flocking to the area to look for the young girl. Approximately 1.5 miles from Colleen's residence, a deputy sheriff was directing traffic caused by volunteer searchers flocking to the area. The sheriff was taking a short break on his three-wheel ATV. He drove down a lonely dirt road that had already been extensively searched when the deputy saw Colleen off the side of the road, covered in scratches, wearing no clothing. When she had left her home, she was wearing a disposable diaper and a beret. Both were gone. The deputy took his shirt off to cover the girl and advised communications that he had found her. He said that she seemed very tired. The night that Colleen disappeared, temperatures had dropped into the 40s, and law enforcement officials were shocked to see that she survived the night. She was transported to a local hospital and released on the same day. So how did Colleen get 1.5 miles from her home in bare feet in less than 24 hours? What happened to her beret and diaper? Why didn't she suffer from exposure when she was essentially naked in the woods with temperatures in the low 40s? These are all questions that will never be answered because Colleen hadn't learned to talk. 18 months old.
Yeah, that's crazy. That doesn't make any sense.
All right. Raymond Mackey. Missing in November, 27th of November in 1936. Keweenaw Woods in Michigan. Age at disappearance, 17 years. So this is a teenager. Raymond lived on the far northern peninsula of Michigan in Copper City. He knew the area very well, understood the associated dangers of being in the woods. On the 27th of November in 1936, he was deer hunting. He dressed for winter weather. His dog accompanied him. He and his friends agreed to meet back at the camp later in the day, and he never returned to the camp, which started a massive search. So the Menominee County Sheriff's Office took the lead on the search for Raymond and was assisted by the Houghton County Sheriff. 6 days into the search, deputies found Raymond's rifle lying on the ground. Several hundred yards from the rifle and in a swamp, they found the interior liner of Raymond's mitten. Searchers returned to their search and rescue camp, and Raymond's dog wandered in. After 2 weeks of 150 men scouring the woods in northern Michigan, deputies called off the search for Raymond. So if Raymond were alive, why would he give up his gloves and rifle? These are a lifeline. Searchers never found any blood in the snow or any other clothing articles. Bears in this region were hibernating during this time period, so they are not suspect. Searchers were completely puzzled about why their search dogs couldn't find a scent trail, even though they found some of Raymond's clothing. Raymond knew not to walk into a swamp area, as this would be a life-threatening maneuver in late November, and yet that is where searchers found his glove liner. And of course, it is interesting that Raymond's dog eventually made it back to camp several days after he went missing. The dog returning indicates possibly that Raymond was long deceased.
So I didn't really listen to that one because
that's fine.
I'm looking up. I'm trying to figure out what's the average pace of an 18-month-old.
Oh, yeah.
2 steps, right?
Yeah.
Because if it's like anywhere around 2 feet, let's see, that's almost 4,000 paces to go a mile and a half.
Yeah.
So it's like, you know, a person can go a mile and a half in like 1,500 paces.
Yeah.
Or less.
Yeah.
So they'd have to go like, you know, I don't know if it's 2 feet. That seems big for an eight, for.
Yeah, it does seem large for an 18-month-old. And I mean, can they even walk, really?
Yeah, yeah. That's okay. When they're walking.
Staggering.
They're coming.
It's a constant stagger, right?
It says, so this is just some random website I'm looking at. Your child will rapidly become more sure-footed between 16 and 18 months.
Okay.
A beginning walker staggers about with hands held high for balance. Gradually, though, they'll begin to feel more comfortable walking with hands and feet at sides. By 18 months, they'll smooth out that awkward wide-legged lurch and start walking more smoothly. They may even pick up the pace and try running. Another few milestones, picking up something and carrying it, made possible by better balance and stronger muscles.
Yeah. So
at 18 months, many can climb into chairs and couches.
So trampling through the woods is a possible thing.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Barefoot. Totally
yeah,
barefoot.
Yeah, they're light. You know, they don't weigh as much.
Right.
Like going barefoot for sure. I mean, it's like shoes are, you know, cumbersome at first. They're tripping on them and stuff, and they want to take them off.
Yeah.
But I'm just, you know, that's.
And yeah, I can understand, you know, because it said she was missing her diaper and the hair barrette, right?
Yeah. So that would get getting caught on the.
Right.
On
a tree can snag that out of your hair. Yeah, yeah. You know, the diaper can get torn off.
Yeah.
It's weird that they didn't ever find him. Because, like, in a lot of these cases, they're, like, finding the guy's lighter and his smokes.
Yeah,
you know,
yeah,
it's like,
yeah, that's
but
weird.
You don't find any of the clothes. It's weird. Right.
But still, I just, you know, rounding it, you could say that it would be, you know, basically taking four times the amount of steps that it would take a human to go that far.
An
so
adult.
That's a.
Yeah.
Yeah.
An adult.
So that'd be like
said human.
I mean, as a human.
<You're> right.
They're not really humans yet.
So the reason I picked out the Raymond case, he's 17 years old, so he should, you know, I mean, teenagers do dumb stuff, but it's what they find that's weird. They find his rifle, and a couple of hundred yards from the rifle, in a swamp, they find the interior liner of one of his mittens.
One glove, yeah.
And that's it. Nothing else. But the dog comes back.
Yeah, that's weird.
Okay.
You got beamed up by UFO.
I know, it's so weird. Okay, one more case here, and then we'll take a break. Kenneth Scott. Missing on 9/28/1958, 2 p.m., Norway Lake in Michigan. Age at disappearance, 4 years. So Norway Lake is located in the far northwest section of Michigan in a region surrounded by heavy forests and swamps. Elmer Scott and his three sons took a short vacation at a hunting lodge or hunting camp at Norway Lake near the Wisconsin border on the upper peninsula of Michigan. Mid-afternoon, September 28th, Kenneth was following his two older brothers through the woods back to the camp, but he couldn't keep up. And the older brothers arrive at the camp, realize that Kenneth had vanished, told their father, and a search party is immediately organized. Local police rally every local person and organized nearly 1,000 participants in the search for Kenneth. Helicopters, airplanes, horsemen, ground troops worked through rain in their efforts to find the boy. The area they were searching had very thick woods with swamps, bears, and other wild animals. Temperatures in the region dropped to 46 degrees on some nights that Scott was missing. Early on Thursday morning, a helicopter was flying low over the trees, saw a small bundle on the ground. The helicopter crew led ground forces to the bundle and found that it was Kenneth. He was dead on a hillside, quite a distance from the point where he disappeared. An October 3rd, 1958 article in the Milwaukee Sentinel had the following. The boy lay face up in a little clearing, his light jacket beside him. Searchers said he had apparently wandered approximately 15 miles through swamp and had come out onto higher ground before deciding to rest sometime on Tuesday. So, let's see. I think that's only a couple of days after he disappeared. It'll probably come up later. So the coroner who examined the body stated that he had died sometime Tuesday of exposure. Yeah, 2 days. So searchers stated that Kenneth wandered 15 miles in 2 days through swamps and uphills. Paulides says, according to the book Lost Person Behavior on page 135, children 4 to 6 years old are located more than 95% of the time in less than a 4.1 mile radius from the point last seen if traveling on flat ground. This doesn't include traveling across swamps, which means Kenneth is so far outside the search guidelines recommended by experts that it's ludicrous.
He traveled more than triple the distance of the maximum acknowledged in the search criteria of the book, and he was found on up on a hill. So, yeah, I guess they found him Thursday. He had died Tuesday. 15 miles away, 4 years old. Mm. Now, it's not impossible, right? You and I, we discussed this case the other night.
Yeah.
So that we you know, we go back and forth. Kyle has a five-year-old.
Yeah.
Soul's five. So we go back and forth discussing these cases. And I agree that this is not impossible. It's just, it does seem to be outside of the norm. And like the book says, 95% of the time, children this age will be within a 4 mile radius on flat and easy ground. So that does say that 5% are found outside of it, but are they getting that 5% from cases like this? Right.
Right.
Basically, it means almost every time, you know, under more normal circumstances, they won't go that far.
Yeah. Yep. It's weird.
Yeah. All right.
And also weird that the older brothers like would be, you know, running off and leaving, you know.
Yeah. Well, I kind of understood that. I was an older brother, you know, and you're like, you're walking through the woods and you're like, come on, man. And he doesn't keep up and you're just kind of annoyed and you just keep going and you get to the camp and then you realize, wow, he's not back there. And then you'd like, dad, you know, but to me, that was like.
Yeah, you can construct a reasonable scenario for that.
Yeah.
For sure.
To me, I was just like, yes, I can see how that could happen. You're kind of, you know, the little brother's not keeping up and you're just.
Yeah.
You're just being
an
asshole.
He's probably back there whining.
Yeah.
Guys.
Well, and the older brother's being an asshole about it, you know, like zero sympathy.
Yeah.
But it's, again, it's point of separation.
Right. Yeah.
Yeah.
Man. Sucks.
Yep. All right. Let's take a break.
All right.
And we are back, ladies and gentlemen, brothers of the Serpent podcast, exploring David Paulides' missing 411 books for the Eastern United States and very strange disappearances of very young children. So we're still in Michigan here. The next case is for a little girl named Carol Van Hulla. Went missing on 6/28/1959 at 6 p.m. They were in Dickinson County Picnic Ground in Michigan. Age at disappearance, 3 years old. So Mr. and Mrs. Joseph Van Hulla and their four daughters traveled to the Dickinson County Picnic Grounds at Norway Lake. Around dinner time, the family realized that Carol had somehow vanished. The family quickly searched for their daughter and then notified law enforcement. So a full-fledged search was started within 1 hour of her disappearance, which included 500 searchers, helicopters, and bloodhounds. The first night of the search was not eventful, and searchers had a difficult time finding anything. Bloodhounds could not find the girl, even though handlers stated that they had found her scent from time to time. So this is another interesting thing. It's like, this is why I'd like to talk to these dog people. You know, it's one thing when you don't know where the person, like if you don't have a starting point.
Yeah,
but they know the little girl was at this campground, you know, so the dogs can find the scent.
Yeah, and the parents have items that belong to the child.
Yes, exactly. And, yeah. Right. So this one, it says they couldn't find the girl. The bloodhounds couldn't find the girl, even though handlers stated that they had found her scent from time to time.
Yeah.
During the 13th hour that Carol was missing, searchers were working their way through a heavy swamp. So notice how often
swamps.
When they thought they heard crying. They broke through heavy brush and found Carol asleep on a small mound in the middle of water, crying in her sleep. So in a June 30th, 1959 article in the Milwaukee Sentinel, it says, although the spot where Carol was found is about 1 mile from the picnic grounds, authorities believe she had covered 5 miles in her wanderings. The search, begun an hour after Carol disappeared, involved the first major use of Michigan-Wisconsin Rescue Unit, organized to include men and equipment of various agencies. Since Kenny Scott, age 4, of Kingsford, Michigan, vanished under similar circumstances last September. Kenny was found dead of exposure 4 days later, 7 miles from where Carol was discovered.
Oh, man. How long before? The year before?
Yes. So that's the previous case we had read was Kenneth Scott. That's why I did these two cases in a row, and that's why Paulides has them in a row in here, too. So basically, the implication is that possibly the same thing did this, whatever it was.
Yeah.
You know, Carol was found Kenny was found dead of exposure 7 miles from when Carol was discovered the previous year.
That's weird.
Yeah. So they were searching for Carol, they used a search and rescue unit that had been organized based on Kenneth's disappearance.
Oh.
So a June 30th, 1959 article in The Sun says this: following sounds of a child's crying, two 18-year-old youths wading through a swamp waist deep in water found Carol asleep on a mound surrounded by water. She was taken to the hospital for observation. She had numerous scratches and a slight case of exposure, but was doing well. So the next question here is, if these 18-year-olds are waist deep in water in a swamp, how did this 3-year-old little girl get to this little mound out in the middle of that water? I mean, can 3-year-olds swim? I guess.
Maybe some of them, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, I'm sure. But the real question is, was the mound, like, the mound, was it made of, like, burnt rocks?
No.
I was, like, really hard to make a joke right now, but still.
Yeah.
It was burnt rocks from an old castle.
Yeah. Possibly.
In the swamp.
Burnt down, fell over, and sank into the swamp.
God. That was Ty's joke.
That's right. That's right. We were going through some of these the other night.
It's hard to make a joke in this, but I had to do it.
Yeah.
Sorry.
Hey, she was found alive.
Yeah, I know. But I don't know how. The other thing is it just water, or is it like
mud,
you know, something that grown people have to wade through, but like a child can kind of.
Right. Like if there's a lot of grasses, could the child sort of
walk on the grasses or something, you know,
swan their way across the grass without sinking into the water
I
too
don't
deep?
Know.
Yeah.
But and probably not.
3 years old is. I mean, could you ask them what happened?
No.
No?
I mean, you can, but.
Yeah.
So Paulides
says two missing children from the same lake in 9 months to the day is an unusual set of events. Both children disappeared in a 4-hour window of each other. So, like, basically in the evening, right? Carol was reported missing at 6.
What time of year was it for both? Was it the same time of year?
No. Kenneth was missing. For some reason, my brain will not connect the numbers to the months. What is the 9th month?
September.
Okay.
Yeah, I have the same problem.
Yeah, I'm like, it was 9. I don't know. Yeah, so September at 2 p.m. he was reported missing. He was 4. Same lake, but a different area of the lake. Carol went missing in July 6. Is that? Yeah. No, June.
Okay.
She's 3 years old and missing at 6 p.m. So the window of disappearance is the same. Is like there's a 4-hour window there in terms of the daytime. But yeah, it's a different month. So this is the middle of the summer. So she wasn't in danger of
dying of exposure.
Right. But they still said that she had a slight case of exposure. But it might have been. I don't know if that meant that what that means.
Yeah.
It's not cold exposure, probably. But she did stay out overnight. Okay. So the book Lost Person Behavior by Robert Koester states that a 1 to 3-year-old child will be found 95% of the time on flat ground in less than 2 miles from the point last seen. Carol had traveled over 2.5 times that distance. And he says the more disturbing question is how Carol got under the mound surrounded by water. If the water is waist deep for adults, there is no way a 3-year-old could walk through that to the ground. Plus, she had to traverse thick bushes and bad terrain. The explanation here doesn't make any sense, Paulides says. Okay. So now we're going to Illinois. And this is a 3-year-old named Helen Chenoweth. Missing 3/28 in 1940, the 28th of, let's see, March of 1940, 6 p.m. in Breeds, Illinois. So the Chenoweth family owned a farm on the outskirts of Breeds, 8 miles east of Canton. In the early evening of March 28th, Helen, 3 years old, was staying at the farm with William Long, 17 years old, who was a cousin, and her younger brother, Howard, who was 5 years old. At some point, Helen disappears. Parents notified, search immediately ensues. Police questioned William and took him into custody for further questioning. So the police immediately suspect the 17-year-old cousin. While William was in custody, law enforcement continued to search the area up to 2 miles from the farm for the little girl. The night she disappeared, there was a rainstorm that lasted many hours and washed away any tracks she may have made. 47 hours after Helen disappeared, a deputy was walking in, to an outer area to search when they were on an adjacent farm and climbing up a hill. The hill the deputies were climbing included a pig lot and mud. As they went up the hill, they saw a small bulge in the mud, but the bulge appeared to have clean clothing. The deputies walked to the bulge and found Helen unconscious but alive. She had clean hands and feet, and her clothes were barely wrinkled. The more amazing fact was her clothes were dry. So remember, it had been raining heavily.
For hours, yes. Yeah.
They picked the girl up and took her home and later to a hospital. She was 3/4 of a mile from her farm, 47 hours after she disappeared. The area she was found had been searched many times, and she was not there on those times. An April 1st article in the Pittsburgh Press stated, she couldn't tell the story of her adventures. Sheriff Ralph Cook said the child's clothes, face, and hands were clean and that she hardly could have survived 2 nights in the open under unfavorable weather conditions. The deputy who found her was interviewed by the Telegraph Herald on the 31st of March and stated the following. Although the child was unharmed, Moore said he did believe that she had been held captive by someone who decided to release her Saturday because of fear of being detected. Her clothes were dry, did not appear as though they had been wet, despite the fact that a heavy rain drenched the district the night she disappeared. So,
and why was she unconscious? Like,
I don't know.
That's weird. Mm-hmm. Like, was she just sleeping in the mud?
Right. She's put in the mud in a pig area, basically, yeah. And her clothes are clean.
Yeah.
It's like something placed her there, and she didn't move.
And the fact that she was unconscious when found is like, how do you get that to happen?
Right. Yeah. It's strange.
So the guy, that's another, it's like the guy picks her up, she stays unconscious, or does she wake up?
Yeah.
You know, what was the type of unconsciousness that we're dealing with here?
Yeah.
Was she knocked out, right?
Right. Yeah. So the sheriff's department releases the cousin, William Long, without any charges filed because it was obvious when she had been found to everybody involved that he did not play any part in her disappearance. Paulides says, this is blatantly obvious to all law enforcement involved in this case that Helen had been abducted and later released. It would appear that someone placed the girl in the pig lot just prior to her being found. She was too clean to have been walking in the area, and she was dry despite all the rain. So the real question is, who was roaming near a remote farm and abducted the child?
Yeah. But, I don't know. I'm stuck on the unconscious thing because...
Yeah.
If they took her to a hospital, they should be like, blunt force trauma to the head
right,
or something,
right? She's got a contusion on the back of her head that knocked her out. Yeah.
There's nothing about that in there, which suggests that they didn't find that.
Right. It may have been some form of drugging.
A drug, yeah, okay. But, they would have found that.
Yeah, it's like, would they know if she'd been chloroformed? You know, this was in 1940. So if somebody like chloroformed her with a rag.
Yeah, that's a good point.
I mean, I'm not sure because I don't know too much, but it's possible you could be in danger of killing a child doing that. But would they have tested? They're thinking, I don't know. In this case, it seems like the police were like, look, she was abducted,
Right.
So maybe they would test for that. Like, I just don't know. I don't know what the capabilities were in 1940.
Okay. Footprints in the mud, in the pig pen. Come on.
Where are the footprints?
Come on, guys.
Yeah.
But I guess if it was searched, there might have been a lot of footprints around it.
Yeah.
And so then it would have been easy cover for somebody to come in. And
yeah.
Yeah, and it's interesting. Like, they were finding nothing. Why did the person decide to
go back over there
to drop her down? Yeah, to let her go. It's like, were they in danger of being discovered if the search kept going? Is that what the deal is? And so they're like, I don't want to be found, so I'll leave the child. So they'll find the child, and then they'll stop looking, and they won't find me. Is that like, you know, you kind of see that possibly, you know, with a lot of these kids who are found alive, especially when they're found in places that were being searched. Somebody knows where the searchers are, is worried maybe that the searchers are getting close to their location. They don't want to be found themselves, and they're willing to let the kid go in order to stop the search so that they're not located, which is weird.
It's creepy.
Yeah.
And how do they get in there undetected in the middle of a search area?
Right.
Because these places have already been searched.
Exactly. It's so strange. Okay. So we're still in Illinois. Hannah Klemecki. Missing 6/13/07. So let's see. Is that...
And it was, you know...
2007.
If it's on a farm, sorry. You got to get into the farm.
Yeah.
And are you on foot?
Right.
Carrying the child?
Yeah.
While there's a search area going on nearby?
Right.
You know, or are you driving into the farm?
Yeah.
And then it seems like, you know, the police would be like, all right, let's talk to the farmer.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
Did anyone drive into your property?
Right.
It's just weird, right?
Yeah, it is. Those are questions I ask too. Like, is it possible that there was just some like real creeper on this farm nearby that stole the girl? You know, I don't know. But that, I'm like, how are you going to raise a child? You know, I don't know. It does happen. People are kept in basements. You know, I don't know. It's just strange. Okay. So Hannah was 5 years old. So
but then the fear of being identified.
Yeah. Yeah.
So it's like they don't have a fear of being identified.
Right.
I don't know. It's just weird.
It's just strange. All right. So Paulides says, some of the greatest memories we have as children are the special times we spend with grandparents. And that's what Hannah Klemecki was doing June 13th in 2007. Hannah had left her home to go boating with her grandfather, David Klemecki, who was 62. David and Hannah were riding the waves and enjoying the solitude offered by remote locations along a stretch of the river. Moments is just west of the La Salle Fish and Wildlife area of the Wetlands Nature Preserve in Illinois. There are areas along this stretch of river that are very wild and lush and with very few people. So sometime in the late afternoon or early evening, David pulled their boat up to an island in the middle of the river. He roped the boat into position and jumped into the water, and for some unknown reason, he did not resurface. Hannah lost sight of him. She was wearing arm floaters, and apparently she went into the river and came out on the sand of a nearby bank. Admittedly, this portion of the story is vague, and Hannah has not offered a lot of clarity. So they're getting this from the child when she was found later, okay? Once Hannah and David didn't return from their trip, Hannah's parents contact the sheriff and a search ensues. 2 days, the sheriff's office felt that Hannah must have drowned. They were scraping the bottom of the river looking for a body, but didn't find it. On the 15th of June, the sheriff found the body of David floating downstream approximately 3/4 of a mile from where he went in. The sheriff's team was on the sand, recovering the body of David, when out of the bushes behind them walked a naked 5-year-old girl eating a handful of wild mulberries.
Oh my gosh.
It was Hannah. She had scratches over her entire body, no clothes on, and was in good health. She was taken to the hospital and found to be in good condition. Her parents were shocked she was alive, and equally shocked that she walked out of the vegetation and right up to the searchers almost like she was delivered there, fed, and on time. So what happened
to David? In the same place, but this is the place that they found his body?
Yeah. They're recovering his body on the bank of the river, and she just walks out of the woods behind them, wearing no clothes, holding a handful of berries.
That is crazy.
That's weird. So all this stuff about him diving into the water after tying up the boat and not coming back up, that was what she told people after having been recovered. That, you know, nobody witnessed any of those details, but she's like, yeah, we tied up the boat on a rock in the middle of the river. He jumped in and just never surfaced. And then she is wearing arm floaters. She kind of freaks out. She jumps in, and then the river sweeps her to the bank. But she doesn't have any other details about where she was missing for five freaking days and how she just walked up behind the searchers 3/4 of a mile down the river from where her father or her grandfather jumped in the water and never surfaced. So it's like, I guess, could he have jumped in and broken his neck or something? You know, like he dives in and hurts himself. But it's weird that he didn't surface. I don't know. It's a strange story.
Yeah, it's weird.
Yeah.
I'm going all freaking UFO on this thing, but is that story implanted?
Right. Yeah. Is it a screen memory? Yeah. Yeah. And I wish there was more details on the condition of the father's or the grandfather's body. It just says that they found his body floating downstream. So it was not even on the shore. It was floating downstream. 3/4 of a mile from where he went in.
Probably would have been just not like in the middle of the
flow. Right, he was like
stuck up on the bank, near the bank somewhere.
They were on the sand recovering the body, and then she walked out. It just doesn't tell you, did he drown or did he hurt himself? It doesn't say, there's no details. That's what I'm saying. Okay. Arkansas.
God, what a horrific experience.
Yeah.
She has to grow up
remembering.
Yeah. Well, let's see. She was 5 years old. So, yeah. You might have some memories from when you're five. It's pretty rare, though.
Yeah.
Very few and far between, right? But, yeah, she'll probably remember that. Okay, so Arkansas, Florence Jackson went missing September 6, 1937, Oak Grove in Arkansas. Age at disappearance, 4 years old. Mr. and Mrs. Jackson and their daughter Florence traveled from their home in Chelsea, Oklahoma, to visit relatives in Oak Grove in Arkansas.
I just thought of something. Sorry, I keep doing this.
Chelsea.
If the water was cold, and he's like a older guy.
Yeah, he could have.
He jumps in and he gets that shock of, and just, had a heart attack or something.
Yeah, it was in June in Illinois, so I guess it could have been cold water.
I don't know. Yeah. That was just a thought, right?
Yeah, but it is important to look at the season when this takes place.
Yeah,
so
for sure.
Six, right? That's June. Is that July? June? Shit. Yeah, it's June. Right. July is 7. We need a calendar up on the screen so I can see this easily. Okay, so Florence and her parents went to Oak Grove in Arkansas, Monday afternoon, September 6th in 1937. The parents went with Florence's grandfather to a wooded section outside the city while Florence and the grandfather took a walk to an abandoned sawmill. Halfway to the mill, Florence stated she wanted to go back to the car where her mother and father were located and turned and ran back towards the car, and she never made it. The grandfather gets back to the auto and finds Florence was not there, and they call authorities. So this, right there, the first thing that people will say was, like, well, the grandfather did it. He's the last person, the person who was the last to see them alive is the immediate suspect. The only story you get is, he comes back and says, well, she said she ran back to the car.
Yeah.
Right. So that would be the immediate suspicion. The area of Berryville and Oak Grove responded en masse as 400 searchers attempted to find Florence. For 4 days, deputies and volunteers covered a vast area in an attempt to find the girl, and they did find evidence. On a September 9th, 1937 article in the Joplin Globe had the following. Shoes and stockings of the little girl were discovered late Tuesday afternoon by searchers within half a mile of where she was last seen. Tonight, however, no further trace of her had been found. The stockings were found on the side of a high ridge and were about 15 yards apart, the sheriff said. Down the mountainside and high on another ridge, a quarter mile away, her shoes were found. So this starts to rule out the grandfather because he's not going to have time to, run all these ridges before he comes back to the car to tell the parents that he doesn't know where she is. So this finding stumped the searchers. Why would a little girl take stockings off at 15-yard intervals? It was almost as though someone was carrying her and stripping her clothing as he or she was running. Searchers were also stymied by heavy rain that hit the Oak Grove area after she disappeared. Reading further in the same Globe article was the following. I believe she is alive, Sheriff Morris said, but finding her will be like finding a needle in a haystack. This country is the roughest that you can imagine. Late on September 10th, so that's 4 days after she went missing, a farmer's wife was outside her residence 7 miles from where Florence disappeared and thought she heard someone calling to her. Mrs. A.W. Godwin walked around her residence down to Indian Creek and saw naked Florence Jackson asking for help. All of her clothing was gone. Her hair was full of burrs. She was carrying a tomato and a handful of sheep sorrel.
What's sheep sorrel?
Like food for sheep? I don't know. May I look it up?
Yeah.
She told Mrs. Godwin that she didn't think she could cross the creek, and could she come and get her? So the woman goes through the creek, grabs Florence, brings her into the house. Authorities are called. Florence told the Godwins that she had just eaten wild grapes, tomatoes, and lots of sheep sorrel. You find it?
It's a flowering plant considered a perennial weed. It's okay. Native to Europe, Russia, the Middle East, and North Africa, as well as being prevalent in all parts of the United States. It's been historically used to treat inflammation, scurvy, cancer, and diarrhea.
Okay. I don't even know what to say to that. So she tells her, yeah, she'd eaten grapes, tomatoes, and sheep sorrel. Mr. and Mrs. Jackson were escorted to the Godwin farm where they met with Florence, their daughter. Florence was taken to a local hospital where she was found to have scratches almost over her entire body and a mild temperature, but was otherwise fine. Fine. Once she was at the hospital, local law enforcement officers did meet and question her about her ordeal. The consensus of police was that there was a good likelihood she was abducted, and they wanted to hear her complete story. The Northwest Arkansas Times ran a lengthy story about this incident on September 11th, 1937. Here are a few excerpts. Local officers listened closely to everything she said in view of the theory she might have been temporarily abducted, but it was difficult to distinguish between actual experience and what she might have dreamed in fitful slumber in the forest.
How old was she again?
4 years old.
Yeah. It's in my experience, you try to get even a simple, like, what happened? And they don't give you anything, or they give you, if you ask again, it's different. It's just like,
right.
It's really hard to.
Yeah.
Sometimes it's, you can get the same information every time, but it's, you just never know. It's so
right. But let's say that, let's give just an example. If I came to your house while Sol was playing outside and I was like, hey, Sol, let's go to the top. Right. And so he jumps in my car with me and we drive up to the top. And then later I bring him back down and let him out in the yard. And you guys are like freaking out, searching for him everywhere. And then I let him back out in the yard and I take off, you know, and then you ask him where to go. And he would tell you like, well, Uncle Russ picked me up and we went up to the top. Right. He would give you at least that, like,
yeah,
that a
probably.
Person picked you up, you know, like there would be, it would be not totally, you know, not understandable. Like he might make up stories about what he did while he was up there. You know, we were playing, you know, the dinosaur and whatever. But you would get the idea that some person had picked him up, you know, and we went somewhere.
Yeah.
I don't know.
Yeah, it could be like that. Or he might freak out because we're freaking out.
Oh, yeah. Okay. Yeah.
And then not want to say what happened because we're upset and he doesn't, you know, I mean, just, I don't know. It's weird.
Yeah. Like, okay.
Yeah. You might, you definitely could possibly get that information.
Should we try it for science? God.
No, I think the watcher's going to join us, though.
Oh, okay, good.
Yeah, he said 5 minutes, which is probably like 20 minutes. So.
Yeah, okay. Okay, so later the same article states, one night she said, Florence said, she slept on a log or inside a log, possibly. When darkness fell, she told of climbing a tree. Another night, she recalled sleeping on a flat rock, and she said she got cold and called for her mother. It was unclear whether she was calling for her mother or someone else in the area.
Mm.
Later, the article states, once she hid in the woods when she saw two strange men. It was unclear who these men were or what they were, what was strange about them. Now, this may, when I was reading this, I was thinking maybe these are the searchers. It's possible that she hid from searchers. You know,
Yeah.
So, one of the more fascinating parts of the story dealt with Florence's next statement. Quote, she told of spending one of the nights in a house deep in the forest. Quote, after a black man and woman picked me up and took me there, she said, and related that they, quote, put me on a cot that night, then gave me breakfast and told me to get going on. I was mad and hit them with my hands, she said.
Wow.
That is weird. No such cottage exists,
I assume. The writer of the story stated that he or she couldn't tell by her recollection what was true or false.
That's what I mean.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's... You might get the information, but you never know which...
Right, they're not lying to you.
Yeah, which parts of the information are actually what happened.
Right.
Because you'll get all this stuff, and then when you ask again, you might get something different. And then you're like, okay, well, the first thing they told me was this, and then later they told me this other thing.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But so the details, aside from what the kid says, because I agree with you, it's hard to parse what the children say. So aside from that, the details are she vanishes basically after telling her grandfather that she's going to go back to the car. Point of separation. The grandfather finishes his walk to the salt. He doesn't think there's a big deal, right? You know, like if we're going to take him at his word, which apparently the cops did, like he obviously didn't abduct her. She showed up way later when he was involved in this. Like, you know, he didn't do this, right? If she was never found, it's easy to think, well, maybe he killed her or whatever, something weird like that, you know, or some accident happened that he was trying to hide from everybody. But basically, according to his story, they're walking up a trail to a sawmill away from where the family had the car. And she decides part of the way there that she doesn't want to go and she's going to turn back. And he's like, you know, it's in view of where we were. It's not a big deal. So he keeps walking. She never makes it back to the car. Nobody realizes this until he comes back because the parents don't know that she's turned around to come back. Right. He doesn't know that she didn't make it until he gets back. They start the search immediately. They find part of her clothing, like her stockings on one ridge and her shoes on another one across a valley. The rest of her clothes are never found. But she shows up at that woman's house across the creek from that woman's house totally naked.
Yeah.
And she's got food, right?
A tomato.
She's holding a tomato and whatever the sorrel is,
this
herb that you can eat, I guess.
Yeah.
And she says she ate wild grapes, tomatoes. Maybe there's wild tomatoes growing. I don't know. Maybe the farm had tomatoes. I don't know. It's a strange story.
That is really weird, yeah.
And she was missing for, you know, days. Let's see if
5 days.
Yeah,
right?
5 days.
That's insane.
So that's the data that we have. Now, her story makes it really strange, but even without her story about strange cabins in the woods with people, you know, who let her sleep on a cot and then tell her to leave after giving her breakfast. You know, and she's like, I got mad and hit them with my hands, right? She's like pounding on these Sasquatches out in the middle of the woods.
Because they're making her leave. Yeah.
She's like, I don't want to go. Get out of here, little girl. We gave you breakfast, you know? Okay.
And it's crazy that plant, the sheep sorrel, is like, it's growing wild around there. Or something. I mean, I guess maybe that she could have learned that you can eat that.
Yeah. Yeah. It's strange. And
I mean, that's totally plausible.
Yeah. Like I'll also point out look how often berries show up in this, you know, and Paulides makes a point to this too. He's like, berries are a point of interest, you know? Okay. So still in Arkansas, Catherine Van Alst, missing 6/16/1946 at 2:30 PM. Devil's Den State Park in Arkansas. Age of disappearance, 8. So the Van Alst family left their home in Kansas City and went vacationing in western Arkansas. They drove to Devil's Den State Park, rented a cabin. After unpacking, the father took Jean, who was 13, Bobby, who was 11, and Catherine, who was 8, to Lee's Creek in an area where there was a small dam. Once they arrived at Devil's Den Dam, the children started to play in the water, and Catherine fell into a deep portion of the upper dam where an unknown woman supposedly pulled her out and told her not to play in the deep water. Catherine listened and went to the outflow of the creek below the dam. The outflow had several large boulders and rocks, and this was the last location that Catherine was seen, 2:30 p.m. on June 16th. The elevation of the dam is approximately 1,000 feet, although peaks in the area do go as high as 1,600 feet. After a short period of time, Catherine's brothers realized that they hadn't seen her, and they notify the father. Very short time span, many people are looking for her. Once an initial search could not locate her, the county sheriff and state park rangers were notified, and a formal search was organized. On June 18th, so that would be 2 days later, Washington County Sheriff Cap Gully was in charge of the search and was focusing his efforts in a 16-foot deep pool of water beneath the dam under the belief that Catherine had drowned. The Moberly Monitor, a newspaper, ran an article on June 18th stating the following. The sheriff said it was unlikely that the youngster had wandered into the wooded section of the park and that she had apparently drowned. It was at approximately this time that newspapers reported that Catherine's father had a nervous breakdown and had to be placed under a doctor's care. I can totally understand that.
Oh, yeah.
The sheriff drained the pool below the dam and confirmed that she did not drown, at least not in that pool. Sheriff and his assistants were focusing on the water. Very few resources were being put into searching the surrounding thick forests, and the times were about to change. The superintendent of the Arkansas State Park Systems decided to respond to the search and eventually met with the sheriff. They shared duties with the sheriff and immediately started to put state police dogs, National Guard troops, and others into the mountains to look for the girl. So the Arkansas Times on June 22nd ran the following statement. There is a possibility that Catherine was taken from the area by a passing motorist or other persons. When search and rescue leaders started to make claims about possible abductions, it is an indicator that they are starting to believe that the victim may not be found. On Saturday, June 22nd, at approximately 3:30 p.m., a group of searchers were 7 air miles from where Catherine was last seen. They were making their way up a mountainside, calling her name. As they near the summit, Catherine calls out, "Here I am." University of Arkansas student Porter Chadwick was the first to find Catherine. She was wearing just a bathing suit, nothing else. She had scratches over her entire body, riddled with insect bites. The Santa Fe New Mexican ran a story on June 24th with the following statement. She was found 7 miles as the crow flies from the vacationer's retreat where she set out, but trail-wise, mountaineers believe she had walked dozens of miles through the forests. She was found in an area downstream from the Devil's Den Dam where she vanished. She was later interviewed by law enforcement sources and stated that she remembers sleeping in the warm grass on the first night, but doesn't remember the next days or nights.
Whoa.
She's 8. So this is not like.
I have no experience with an 8-year-old.
Right. She did state that she found a cave high up on a mountainside where she spent the last few nights before she was found. She stated that the cave had a pool of clean water and there were berries that she found in the area and ate them.
Uh-huh.
The recovery of Catherine made worldwide news in 1946. This 8-year-old girl was missing for 6 days and nights without shoes, without pants, without a coat, yet managed to survive even though this was her first time ever in the woods. Rescuers claim that Catherine would have had to walk between 24 to 36 miles to get to the location where she was eventually found wearing no shoes. She managed to make her way through thick and thorny bushes to reach the location of her cave near a mountaintop at nearly 600 feet higher in elevation from where she was last seen. She defies every search and rescue profile regarding an 8-year-old girl. Is this possible? She had never been in the woods, but knew which berries she could eat. Now, that one, if you get hungry enough, you just eat them. I don't know if that means that she knew which ones were good, but unless there's like poisonous ones and non-poisonous ones, and she only eats the non-poisonous ones. That's weird, but it doesn't say that specifically. And also, she just happens to find a cave on a mountaintop with freshwater spring inside of it.
Yeah, that's weird. But so this is cool because you could dig into these stories a little more by looking at the specific area and looking at what grows there. And you determine the type of berries that might be growing at that time of year.
Yeah.
That's a good point.
How many poisonous ones are there versus, you know, so this is, you could actually dig into this.
Yeah. And I'd also want to know, like, does she have, like, are there, you know, is there poison oak, poison ivy, or anything else like that? And did she have any of that? Or did she somehow totally avoid it? You know, of course, I guess she
can't get those answers probably at this point. 1940s.
She was hospitalized for 2 days and released in excellent condition. The doctor stated that she was suffering from multiple cuts and bruises and a minor case of shock, but there was no mention of dehydration or suffering from lack of food.
And no mention of poison oak or poison ivy.
Right. So there you go. Devil's Den State Park.
Wow. All right.
Yep. Taking a break. We'll be back with a few more cases in this book.
And we're back. Fourth and final segment, sadly. God.
Yeah.
This is really good stuff. And also, we are joined by The Watcher. He joined in at the end of the last segment there. Man, buddy, I know this new schedule doesn't work out for you, but I wish you were here for this entire show.
Me too.
Yeah.
It sucks when work gets in the way of podcasting. I feel like life needs to rearrange its priorities.
yeah but glad to have you, even if it's for one segment. So
well, you know, I mean, 25% is better than zero.
Yeah,
I think, sure. Unless my math failed me.
No, that's, I think it is, it's better is, you know, a relative term, but I would say more, it's definitely more than zero.
All right.
It's a higher number. Enough.
And I'm gonna
mute my mic.
Mute the mic. Okay, so I'm not going to read this or go through this, all the details of this, but I do just want to mention it because there is a strange detail in here. So this is Oklahoma. Went missing on, let's see, January, March 30th, 1988 at Lake Texoma in Oklahoma. Age, 2 years old. Name is Larry Dwayne Krebs. So Larry Krebs and his son were on the third day of a camping trip to Lake Texoma in southeastern Oklahoma. Larry and Dwayne were walking on the bank of a river that feeds the lake and were gathering firewood. They were 50 feet from the river with the father walking in front and maybe 8 paces and the son walking to the rear. A September 11th article in the Daily Democrat states how Larry recounts facts of the disappearance. He says that he walked ahead of his son, and when he turned around and looked, Dwayne was gone. He never recalls hearing any splash or any noise. So this one, immediately, again, the father is the suspect, right? They're on they're 3 days into a camping trip, so he has plenty of time to do something terrible, I guess. But apparently, they didn't suspect him. The article went on to report that investigators did follow a pair of small child footprints that led into a small puddle and did not come back out.
Oh, wow. That's weird.
Implying that something picks him up while he's in the puddle, right? So the disappearance of Larry occurred at the far northern end of the lake on the stretch where the historic Fort Washita is located. This area has a Confederate cemetery and some extremely remote and desolate areas. It's directly surrounded by the area directly surrounded by the river is lush with vegetation. There was a massive search. This did include the river being dragged for a body. Nothing was found. 15 years after the incident, Larry's father contacted a psychic and asked for assistance. So this is another, like, I think he puts this in there because it implies that the dad is still trying to find out what happened. You know, in other words, that he didn't do it, possibly. The psychic stated that somebody did abduct the boy, put his hand over his mouth, and took him away. You know, whether you believe that or not. So Paulides says, this is another case where I believe the father, but facts defy belief. Child molesters and abductors go to great lengths to ensure their identity is hidden and they are never seen. The idea that someone hid in the bushes, waited for the Krebs to walk by, just 8 paces behind his dad, jumps out and grabs the boy and runs off, is far-fetched. The person committing this crime would have to be extraordinarily fast, strong, stealthy, and know the area and a route to escape very well. Remember, the risk of an abductor being caught in the middle of nowhere trying to take a child could be very severe. How would the abductor know the father wouldn't turn back and look the precise moment that he or she was taking the child? It appears that Larry walked into a small puddle and was taken before he walked out, thus no tracks leaving the puddle. This is another of a long line of cases where children are taken while in very close proximity to their parents. And Larry Krebs has never been found.
A 2-year-old?
Yeah.
Camping?
Right. It is weird. I agree.
8 paces is like 40 feet.
Is it?
Right?
Yeah, I don't know.
I mean, right? Let's see. Yeah, I mean, 40 feet.
Yeah.
So you're walking in front of your 2-year-old in the woods?
Right. Seems like
40 feet? I don't know. That's not, I wouldn't be doing, yeah. I don't think I'd be doing that.
Yeah. Yeah, I agree. To me, it was that the detail of the searchers finding the footsteps going into the puddle and not coming out is the interesting part. But that could be anything. You know, in other words, that's what they found. So it could be the dad. I don't know. Just saying. Yeah. That's just strange detail there. Okay. Also in Oklahoma, missing on April 22nd of 1999, named Ernest Matthew Cook, 27 years old. So Ernest was living in a what? Watcher?
Sorry. Real quick facts coming in. So a pace is roughly 5 feet. So you said 8 paces?
Yeah.
40 feet.
Yeah.
Also, Lake Texoma is the 12th largest reservoir man-made lake in the United States.
Wow.
One of the Army Corps of Engineers, like, big projects. So plenty of room for something to wander around and not be seen.
Yeah.
And do some crazy stuff. It's also through some semi-interesting, like, eroded out gorges and stuff from the Red River where it's dammed up.
Okay.
Really sort of, it's very reminiscent and very close to the reservoir that is near Rockwall, believe it or not.
Yeah.
So, yeah.
Hmm.
Yeah, I agree with you that the father walking in front of a 2-year-old 40 feet out in front of him that's a little sketchy. That's,
yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Okay. So back to Ernest here. Ernest was living in a camper on property belonging to his grandfather in a rural area of Bosch, Oklahoma. He was recently divorced and the father of 2 young girls. On the night of April 22nd at 10:30 p.m., Ernest's father was driving him back to his camper. His father stated that his son got out of the truck, started to walk towards a wooded area that kept the camper, waved goodbye, and this was the last time he was ever seen. So his dad goes back to the camper the next day to check on his son and finds he's not in the camper. He did find his son's overnight bag in the camper. It was open with his shoes on top of it, along with clean clothes and photos of his 2 daughters. So John, the dad, searches the immediate area, doesn't see his son. 2 days later, John returns to the camp with his dad. They both search the area. 200 yards from the camper and out in the pasture, they find Ernest's sleeping bag and pillow. They continue to look, and further past the sleeping bag, they find a small road. In the middle of the dirt road, they find a barefoot track on the right side and a boot track on the other side. As they push down the road and towards a mud puddle, they again find another barefoot track and a boot track. John Cook was later interviewed and stated he does not believe that his son left the camper voluntarily. So in other words, the implication here is something wearing boots like snags his son out of his camper while he's sleeping. And so the barefoot track is his son because his shoes are in the camper.
Yeah.
And they find the bedding, you know, way out. So it's like something grabs him while he's in his sleeping bag. I don't know. It's such a weird story.
How old is he? He's
27. Yeah, there's a picture of him.
Wow.
So it Paulides says, it appears as though something occurred to Ernest while he was sleeping in his camper. It also appear he was not wearing his shoes and was in his sleeping bag when his sleep was interrupted. The question is, was he grabbed and carried while in his sleeping bag, or was he forced to carry it? The idea of carrying the sleeping bag for warmth may make some sense, but the idea of carrying the pillow makes very little sense.
Yeah.
We don't know if Ernest made the barefoot marks in the mud or someone else. We don't know if the boot marks were there previously or if the person with Ernest made the boot marks. So, in other words, it could have been two totally...
Yeah. Unrelated
tracks. Yeah, unrelated tracks. We also do not know whether Ernest had made the barefoot marks or whether they had been there several days. There are many aspects of this story that need further study. It is somewhat similar to the disappearance of Stephanie Stewart from a lookout tower in Alberta, Canada. Stephanie disappeared in the middle of the night along with her sheets, blanket, and pillow. Refer to missing 411 Western United States for details on Stephanie's disappearance.
Weird.
Yeah, so she disappears out of a lookout tower in the middle of nowhere along with the bed, all the bedding, including the pillow. So it's so strange. I don't know. It's a weird story. Okay. All right. This one I picked specifically because of the disability. Christopher Jones, he's 37 years old when he disappeared. Let's see, January, February, March, April. In April, the 5th of April, 2006, from Holland, Arkansas. Holland, Arkansas is located 20 miles north of Little Rock. Is 20 miles east of the Ozark National Forest. Parts of the perimeter of this city can be quite remote. Chris Jones lived in one of those remote sections in a house trailer. He had a white picket fence and a large creek running to the rear of his property. He had just returned home prior to his disappearance. He had been in the hospital with a severe case of gout that had struck both of his legs, making it almost impossible to walk. He was using crutches to move around. On April 5th, friends and family went to visit Chris and found the front door closed but not locked. His crutches were leaning on his favorite chair. His vehicle was parked in the driveway, and nothing was moved or stolen. Shane Dickinson is Chris's cousin and was interviewed during the investigation. Shane stated, "It was obvious that he was carried out of there, but we don't know how, who, or why." There were continuous ground and air searches, and the property surrounding the trailer. Nothing of value was ever found. Chris had a daughter who was away at the time of the disappearance. Let's see. Law enforcement officials stated that Chris did not have a criminal record, was not under investigation for anything, and was working as an electrician prior to his onset of gout. So the reason I included this is because he couldn't walk.
Yeah.
And then he disappears without a trace. And the crutches are still in the trailer. His car is still there. Crutches are still there. So. Yeah.
Is that it? I mean.
That's it. Yeah. The reason they mentioned the daughter is because she died in an auto accident after he disappeared. So, 3 months after he disappeared, the family were hoping for some reason that he would surface for the funeral. In other words, they were still maybe he disappeared on purpose. But he didn't show up for the funeral. So, yeah, that's all. There's not very many details. Just to me, what stuck out was the dude basically couldn't walk without crutches. And yet he disappeared. There was a big search and he's never been found.
That's wild.
Yeah. Okay. So now we're going to Alabama. This is a case of Nora Moore. She was 78 years old. So this is another one. It's not one of the children's cases, but there's like one detail in there that I just find really strange. So she went missing 7/18 in 1955 at 4 p.m. Gardendale, Alabama. Approximately 15 miles north of Birmingham, Alabama, is the small town of Gardendale. Mrs. Nora Moore was living in an elderly living facility in a rural area when she went outside for an afternoon of sun. At approximately 4 p.m. on July, she had disappeared. Officials from the home searched the immediate area of the residence for the woman and could not find her. The people who managed the home were surprised they couldn't find Mrs. Moore because she had severe ankle and hip injuries that greatly inhibited her ability to walk. So there's that. The formal search lasted 6 days. Searchers found nothing for the first 5 days, which had them greatly concerned. On the sixth day, a searcher was 1/4 of a mile from the home when they found Mrs. Moore lying on her side near a creek in a semi-conscious condition. She was missing her shoes and stockings, and she complained that someone was continuously throwing water on her while she was out in the woods. She could never explain who was throwing the water. She was taken to a hospital, found to be in satisfactory condition, considering 6 days in the woods. As searchers were carrying her from the forest, they found broom sage in the pockets of her sweater. The searchers asked broom where she sage. Got the broom sage, and she could not explain it. When she was later questioned about the 6 days in the woods, she couldn't remember what had happened to her or how she got to where she was found. She had briar scratches over her entire body, but she was in better condition than many searchers thought she should be. How did she evade airplanes, searchers, and others for 6 days is the true question. Many believe she was placed in the location where she was eventually found, and she was someplace else during the majority of the search. How and where she got the broom sage is another million-dollar question.
What is broom sage?
Broom sage is an eatable perennial shrub.
Oh, my gosh.
With a delightful fragrance that lives in the southwestern portion of the United States. How the broom sage got to Alabama and into Nora Moore's pockets is a fascinating question, Paulides says.
So, watch, or one of the other perennial plants was sheep sorrel.
Yeah.
That one of the little girls is holding.
Yeah.
I'd be interested to see the similarities. So she had similarities.
She had broom sage stuffed in the pockets of her jacket, and she's lying on the... because she can't walk.
Yeah.
And she's like, something was throwing water at me the whole time. That's so strange. And, you know, I mean, she's 78. You know, you don't know what... she's in an assisted living, so it's possible that she was, you know, dementia. I don't know. But the point that there's just details in here, you're just like, okay, so even if she was...
yeah, and it'd be interesting to know, like, was the broom sage fresh?
Yeah.
Was it dried?
Right.
You know, what was this like?
Yeah. The fact that she had briar scratches over her body indicates that she was probably carried through the briar patches, as it was nearly impossible for her to walk.
So Sam Squanch doesn't care about briar. Yeah. That's obvious.
Okay, so quick question. The sheep sorrel, what was the story of the person who had that in their pockets?
Well, no, she was holding it in her hand.
Yeah, and she claimed that she had eaten it.
She'd been eating
how old?
Six, four, something.
Yeah, young.
Sheep sorrel is commonly used in alternative cancer treatment.
Yeah, we looked it up. It's like got all these medicinal qualities.
Yeah, it's considered a weed.
Yeah.
But yeah, it also has antiemetic. Anti-diarrhea can help with scurvy if someone goes for a long time without vitamin C.
Yeah, this girl had been missing like 5 or 6 days. She was holding a tomato and sheep sorrel, and she was totally naked when they found her. But she basically walked out of the woods and onto a woman's property, miles away from where she disappeared.
So look up the other one.
Yeah,
and broom tell sage. Us what similarities are.
So tomato,
broom sage.
Tomatoes, by the way, are incredibly high in antioxidants and vitamin C. The connection I see between those two is vitamin C plus something that fights scurvy. I don't really know enough about pediatrics to know if there's a risk, but if she was sick, say had a cold or caught something, vitamin C, especially in high doses, is very beneficial to the immune system.
Mm.
So there's something there. The other one,
broom sage.
There we go. Broom sage, also known as whiskey grass. It's got a bunch of different names, but broom sage is an American desert shrub, like you were saying, in the Southwest.
Desert shrub. She's in Alabama.
Which is very strange. But it is used for landscaping, but also, sorry, give me just a second. Aside from being drought resistant, has a well-developed root system. It holds things in place. It has properties that are considered to be pain-killing. I would imagine, based on being in the sage family and knowing other things that I know about it, that you have a chemical compound close to acetylsalicylic acid, which is also found in willow bark, that is common aspirin.
Wow.
Like they're giving her medicine.
That would be the way that it seems.
That's crazy,
man. It's also in animal hay. It's thrown in with alfalfa on occasion. I'm not really sure what the reason is for that.
Okay, so then in that case, somebody with a farm or something might have a bunch of broom sage.
Could be.
Right.
That's weird.
Yeah. Yeah. Right, so the weird details in that story are she's 78. She can't walk. Yet she evades airplane searchers and everybody else for 6 days. She's got scratches all over her body, which is to be expected if you're trying to wander through the woods. But I don't know, you know, especially if you can't walk very well. But she has broom sage. And she claims that something kept throwing water at her.
And
while
she's
she
not
in the
famished.
Woods.
Like, I mean, you right. don't eat for 6 days.
Right. Yeah. Yeah. Okay. Moving to Georgia here. Murray Upshaw Jr., 2 years old at age of disappearance, missing November 8th, 1940, around noon, 13 miles north of Cartersville in Georgia. So Betty and Murray Upshaw ran a farm 13 miles north of Cartersville and 400 yards off the Knoxville Highway. This is a rural location with very few neighbors. At noon on November 8th, Betty looked out her back window and saw Murray Jr., 2 years old, playing near the tractor in the backyard. There was a small lawn, thick forests start behind the tractor and barn. Betty looked into the backyard minutes later and Murray was gone. So we were talking about this. You were like, yeah. You know, how long is this really? You know, you look away, you're doing some things, you think... And then you look out, they're gone. And you're like, it was just a couple minutes, but it could have been 15, could have been 20.
Yeah.
She runs into the backyard yelling Murray's name, but does not receive an answer. She goes more quickly and covered more area and still couldn't find her son. And then realized that their 8 month old terrier puppy, Nikki, that had been playing with the child was also gone. She remembered that it had been only minutes since she last saw the boy and he couldn't have gone far being just two. When she couldn't find her son, she summons neighbors and police to assist in the search. Hours after Murray disappeared, there are hundreds of volunteers and police combing the ranch. The search was very organized, and people thought they were doing a thorough job. Hours after Murray left and in the middle of the search, heavy rains hit the area of the farm, rains that didn't stop for over 2 days. Within the first 36 hours of Murray's disappearance, Murray Sr. told the press that he felt his son had been kidnapped. He didn't think that his son could get outside the search zone and not have been found at this point. 3 days into the search, volunteers were looking 2 miles from the farm in a very rugged area and found Nikki, the dog, walking. They picked it up and brought it back to the ranch. To the amazement of everyone, including the sheriff, Nikki was dry, clean, and well-fed. She was not hungry, even though she had been gone for over 70 hours. A November 12, 1940 article in the Pittsburgh Times stated the following. In addition to being dry and clean, referring to Nikki, it had been fed so recently that it declined food, they said. The dog had been missing for over 70 hours. Sullivan termed these circumstances peculiar and suspicious, but added quickly that no clues to substantiate a kidnapping theory had been uncovered. So yeah, a dog missing for 70 hours, a little puppy missing for 70 hours is... so well-fed that it declines food when they try to feed it.
Yeah. I wonder what the contents of the stomach were.
Right. Further, the article states, everything else in that section is wet from rain, said Major Lynn Sullivan, State Highway Patrol Chief. We can't explain how the dog came out of the woods without being wet unless somebody brought him there in a car. On the fourth day of the formal search, Murray's body was found at the base of a pine tree on a rugged mountainside, 1.5 miles from his home. A November 13th article in the St. Petersburg Times described the boy's body. Slight scratches appeared on the child's arms and legs, and his nose was bashed in. Later, the same article states, searchers said that leaves and pine twigs near the body indicated the little dog had bedded down beside his master for at least part of the time since the child disappeared. After the body was discovered, Bardo County Sheriff George W. Gaddis went to the scene and gave a press conference. A San Jose Mercury News article on November 12th stated George W. Gaddis called for an immediate inquest. Now they're suspicious. Several articles stated that Murray's body did not show any signs of violence, even though one article did note the scratches and bruises. The inquest concluded that Murray died from exhaustion and exposure, a typical conclusion when there is little evidence of anything else. Okay, so Paulides has a case summary here where he says... As in many of the cases in which a two-year-old is missing from a rural setting, there are questions about the disappearance and the condition of the body. What really happened to his nose? There is one mention in one paper about this condition. No one else wanted to mention it. Scratches and bruises about the body may be normal, but why was he on a rugged hillside? Several articles state that Nikki is believed to have been lying next to Murray because the ground around him was pressed down and twigs were broken. An 8-month-old terrier is a very small dog, so how do they know it was this dog that did this? There were no mention of Nikki's hair found at the scene, so how did they come to their conclusions? yeah, so they're wondering why the dog wasn't soaking wet. He was found on the other side of the mountain, more than a half mile from where the body was eventually found. So why wasn't the dog wet? So, yeah. And the sheriff felt there was enough of a suspicion surrounding this event that he called for an inquest into the case. But Paulides says he could not find anything that discussed the results of the inquest.
How far away was it again? This is...
He was found... 1.5 miles from his house.
Okay.
Yeah. And he was 2 years old. All right. This is another strange one. This is an adult, Christopher Tompkins. It's fairly recent too, from 2002, January 25th, 2002 in Georgia. Age of disappearance, 20 years. Okay, so it says Mrs. Ann McKenzie is the mother of Chris Tompkins. Ann was the babysitter for a man who owned a surveying company, and Ann's son, Chris, worked for him on his 4-man team. On January 25th, 2002, Ann stated that Chris left the home at 8:10 a.m. and drove to the surveyor's office, where he parked his car and rode to the worksite with the business owner. Chris worked the morning hours with the three other men without any incident. But shortly after lunch, all of the workers were walking on the shoulder of Highway 85. The employees were approximately 50 feet apart walking on the highway. When work associates last saw Chris, he was near the back of the group and near the side of the road. A minute more passed, the crew looked behind them, and Chris was gone. There is a tall barbed wire fence between the shoulder of the road and the private property that borders the highway. When the employees went back to the area where Chris was last seen, they found one of his boots lying near the fence and some coins lying near the boots on the grass. They also found tools that Chris had on him lying and scattered around the ground near the fence. The owner of the business called Chris's mother and explained what had happened. They waited until 4:15 p.m. and tried to report him to the sheriff as missing, but the sheriff said they wouldn't take a report until he was missing 24 hours. So this is common if it's an adult. You know, police will assume, like, well, I mean, it's an adult. He can do what he wants.
Yeah.
They're not missing until 24 hours later. So 24 hours passed and an investigation started. The sheriff's found a piece of blue cloth on the barbed wire near where the boot was found. And it was fiber that matched the blue jeans that Chris had been wearing. The area on the other side of the barbed wire fence was best described as heavily wooded, with swamps, snakes, and very thick vegetation. Almost a year after the disappearance of Christopher, the owner of that land where Chris would have had to have crossed once over the fence reported to the sheriff that he found Chris's other boot in the field. This piece of evidence was turned over to the sheriff. So Paulides says in his summary, it's been over 8 years since Chris disappeared and no one has heard from him. I believe this shows something very bad happened to Chris when he went over the barbed wire, and he doesn't believe this was a voluntary disappearance. Details from the scene make him believe that Chris was involved in a struggle that either ended up with Chris getting knocked down or turned sideways so that coins and tools fell from his pockets. There's no way that anyone would walk into the area on the other side of the barbed wire fence without boots or shoes. There is no logical reason why someone would take the shoes off if they wanted to voluntarily leave the job site. It appears that Chris may have been dragged over the fence because cloth from his pants were found in the barbed wire. If someone is carried or turned sideways, tools and coins and personal items may fall from their pockets, as happened in this case. So again, you know, the first easy assumption is one of the coworkers did something to him, and they all, you know, that they're, you know, we're not getting the full details there, but I don't know. It's a strange story.
Yeah. I mean, they're 50 feet apart on a stretch of road. And it's just like, yeah, I don't know. People get hit by a car and sometimes their boots fly off.
Yeah, that's possible. Yeah. But where did the body go?
Yeah, and why, and there's no blood and no, yeah, you know.
All right.
That's just weird, man.
Yeah, it's a strange story. But yeah, you're right. I didn't even think of the car. That's a good point.
I mean, because if he was just alone.
Yeah.
And somebody hit him because they weren't paying attention, then they might just.
Yeah.
Grab the body and take it and just dispose of it somewhere?
Right. Could be. Yeah.
But he's only 50 feet away from people. How do you do that?
Mm-hmm.
You know?
How would they not hear it?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's weird.
Yeah. All right. One more here. David Tippin. Missing August 1st, 2004. From Stockbridge, Georgia. Age at disappearance, 4 years. Sometime early in the morning on August 1st, in 2004, David Tippin woke before his parents, unlocked the rear door of his rural home, and disappeared into the wild countryside south of Atlanta. Stacy and Robert, David's parents, awoke to attend Sunday morning church. They went to David's room and found that he was gone, and the rear door of the house was open. Robert went to the rear yard, called for David, and did not receive a response. A call to emergency services brought an immediate response from law enforcement. The Tippins told law enforcement that their son was mildly autistic. The call for searchers brought off-duty firemen, local residents, and many on-duty law enforcement and personnel. Sunday afternoon brought a response of several canine teams to search for David. The dog teams reportedly took the searchers to a number of neighbors' homes, and for 2 days they could not find the boy. So the dogs are like, keep going to people's houses.
Hmm.
On Tuesday morning, a mile from the Tippin residence, Bobby Hinton, 70 years old, noticed floodlights on at his rental house on his property. The home was used predominantly for storage, and he knew that the front floodlight should not be on unless someone had activated the motion sensor. He walked to the home and found the rear door unlocked and partially opened. He looked inside and saw a small lump on the floor in front of the refrigerator. He walked toward it and found David Tippin unconscious and on the floor in front of the refrigerator. He picked the boy up, brought him back to his main home, where he met with his wife, Martha. She woke the boy and fed him cookies and milk as Bobby called the police, and the boy was quickly taken back to his residence. Robert stated that David had suffered scratches, bug bites, and was moderately dehydrated. An August 3rd, 2004 article in the Elizabethan Star stated the following. The house where David was found had been searched on Sunday. This same item appeared in the following day in the Albany Herald, confirming the Hinton home had been searched. According to an article dated August 4th in the Atlanta Constitution, the boy, when found, was barefoot and wearing a Finding Nemo t-shirt. So the case summary, David says, what would have caused David to leave the comfort of his home and wander into the woods? Where was he when the Hinton home was searched and nothing was found inside? Did he wander in the woods shoeless for 3 days? And if so, why weren't there any notations about cuts and bruises to his feet? Just a notation about scratches on his body and face. And why didn't the canines find David if they were onto his scent? So this area in which he disappeared is less than 1/4 mile from the Clayton County Reservoir and 4 other small lakes in that immediate area. Readers should take note that many of the disappearances occur in close proximity to wilderness areas, lakes, rivers, streams, forest preserves, and parks.
Freaky.
So I guess it's possible that, you know, he wandered into that building after it had been searched.
Yeah.
But what's interesting is the timing here. You know, most of those floodlight things, they turn off after, what, 30 seconds?
Yeah, I know.
45
he's
seconds?
He's asleep.
Right. Yeah. So this guy looks out there and sees the floodlights on, which means that he just got there, you know, like they're not going to stay on for hours.
Right.
You know, most of these, like, they turn off in a matter of minutes. So it implies that whatever, like, he had just arrived or something had just dropped him off there. And then he goes out and finds the kid, like, asleep in front of the refrigerator in that building. And then the mother wakes him, you know, his wife wakes the kid up.
Like, he's able to carry the kid all the way back, and then the wife wakes him up.
Yeah.
This is, again, like, what kind of unconsciousness are we talking about?
Right, yeah. And apparently he wandered for 3 days, no shoes. You know, like he went outside wearing a t-shirt, and that's it, basically. He's not wearing
his
pants.
Underwear or something.
Yeah, he's in his t-shirt and underwear. Yeah, 4 years old.
God.
So, should I do one
These
more?
These just must be like incredibly traumatic and terrifying events for the people involved. I just can't imagine.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, I guess we'll stop there. The next case is a big one. So we'll start that one next week. This is a big case.
Looks like it's going to be more than two shows.
Maybe. Possibly.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's cool. Good picks. Good stuff.
And so again, I want to encourage everybody to get these books. The one we're reading from, that I'm pulling these details from, is Missing 411 to Eastern United States, Unexplained Disappearances of North Americans That Have Never Been Solved by David Paulides. And I don't know. To me, the ones where they're found alive are the most, even though that's the best possible scenario, these are some of the strangest cases.
Yeah.
And the other thing is like, when they're found alive, it's like, you know, it doesn't encourage further investigation.
Yeah.
You know, because it's like the case is over. The person's no longer missing. They're not dead. They haven't been murdered. You know, the kid is alive. Everyone's happy. And so it's like, it's kind of stops. In some cases where we're going through, you know, you can tell the police or the law enforcement people are kind of like they're thinking abduction, you know, in other words, that somebody came and kidnapped the kid
and then freaked out
and dropped it. But which is possible. I don't know. But when they find the kid, you know, do they keep, wouldn't you want to keep trying to figure out what happened? It's just, I guess there's just nothing to go on. You know, what do you do?
Yeah. Pump their stomachs. I want to know what they're eating for 6 days.
Right. Yeah.
And the dog. Yeah. What was it eating?
Yep. And I'd like to know in some cases, like what the condition of the water, the wild water is in some of these areas. Like, can you drink the water without getting really sick?
Well, I mean, I did as a kid.
Yeah.
We drank the creek water.
So that's what I'm saying. But not everywhere. You can't do that everywhere. So in some cases you can. Like, yes, it's possible to drink the water without getting super sick. But in other cases, it's not.
Yeah.
So. Yeah. All right.
Yes. Interesting.
Yeah. Okay. Well, you guys can get a hold of us, brothersoftheserpent@gmail.com. Check out the website, brothersoftheserpent.com. That's got all the podcast-related stuff there, the encyclopedia, the glossary, the snake skins, which is our merchandise store. So if you want T-shirts or other swag, hats, you can check that out. It's on the website. Join the pyramid scheme. Sign up to our Patreon to get Patreon content. We are making Patreon content now, so there are quite a few things up there now. We don't make them every week, but we've been making them like, what, twice a month? Something like that.
Yeah, I guess.
Yeah, two times a month. So every other show, you know, it'll be on and off. But yes, there is Patreon content now, so if you want to get that, you can sign up to the Patreon. Or if you want to give us a one-time donation, there is a PayPal button there. And thanks so much to all of you who have done that. We really appreciate it. It really helps us out. So thank you so much. And give us reviews wherever you can. Join the Facebook group if you want to do that. Join the Discord. There's a link to joining the Discord on the website as well. That's run by Jeff, who also runs the Library of the Serpent. There are links to that on the website as also. And thanks to History Shift, who makes all of our YouTube videos. He puts a lot of work into that. Thanks, buddy. We really appreciate that. And Pod Doodles, check him out. He does doodles that you can watch him drawing while listening to our show. He's got a YouTube channel, so check that out and follow him on Twitter @PodDoodles. And thanks to Soraya from Where Did the Road Go, Ben from Uncharted X, and the dudes over at Grimerica, and all of you listeners out there. We love you guys.
Always have.
Always will.
Good night, Adamu.
Get back to work.